playoff, 1984. The Los Angeles Express, which stormed to 7 victories in its last 9 games to take the Pacific Division title, host the defending 1983 league champion, Michigan Panthers. It's the USFL. Hello again, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt. There have been rumors of a player strike for the playoffs this week by the newly formed Players Union here in the USFL. It would be catastrophic if it took place. I don't think it will. The teams have been on the field. They have warmed up. There has also been sale talk here. Reportedly, the financially troubled Bill Oldenburg, the owner of the Express, has put his club on the market. That reported by an LA newspaper. Nonetheless, the playoffs are about to begin as scheduled, and we have one of the more interesting matchups taking place today here at the LA Coliseum. The Express, certainly one of the younger teams in the league, against the defending champions of this league, the Michigan Panthers, one of the more experienced. And I think it is also ironic and very interesting how these clubs got here to the playoffs. The scenario begins April 1st. At the time, the Michigan Panthers had won their first 6 games of the season. They were seemingly dominating the league. Everybody was healthy and the club was playing well. While the young Los Angeles Express struggled with just 2 wins in the first 6 weeks, and LA head coach John Hadle came under fire from owner Bill Oldenburg. But then April 1st, roles reversed and misfortune fell on the Panthers. All-pro wide receiver Anthony Carter suffered a severe fracture of his arm. He was lost for the season. That weekend also marked the debut of Steve Young in Los Angeles. And with Young at the helm, LA has doubled its scoring production. The sputtering offense has become more balanced. So look at these numbers. The banged-up Panthers have had 8 all-pros miss games with injuries. Consequently, they've won only 4 of their final 12 games. While the Express enter as the champions of the Pacific Division, LA has matured, blended together, and getting stronger as the season progressed. I think, Lee Grosskopf, it is easy to see why LA would be favored today, and they are the favorites. Michigan's problems have been well documented with the contract disputes, the injuries, with the players like Lacey and Godfrey jumping leagues to the NFL. But my question to you is, should they be heavily favored?
Tim, I think they should be favored, but don't rule out the defending champions. They have won 3 of their last 4 games. They do have the veterans who have the playoff experience, and I don't think that they will panic, and they will probably peak at the right time. However, Los Angeles is very much like Michigan was in 1983. They're a talented young group of players who started slowly, began to gel at midseason, and have peaked late in the year. And I have said recently that I think that they have what it takes to beat anyone in the league.
One of the most intriguing matchups for the fans today has to be the quarterback. It certainly is the most publicized, and we've got 2 good quarterbacks here today.
I think we have the most compelling matchup of the year in Bobby Hebert, the Cinderella quarterback of 1983 on the left, going against the $40 million man, Steve Young, on the right. And Hebert, as we look at him in action right here, has had his problems. You mentioned them. He's playing with an injured knee. He's thrown the interceptions. He's had the sacks. There have been the turnovers. But despite all that, Jim Stanley feels that he is the man to lead them back to the championship game, because in addition to the short and intermediate range passes, he has this dimension. He can throw deep, and he has one of the best deep threats in the league right here in number 29, Derek Holloway. So Bobby Hebert, despite all the problems he's had this year, still is the key to their offense. Steve Young is the greatest impact player in the league this season, and I have never seen a player have quite the ability to throw the football, as particularly as an intermediate range passer, and also double as a breakaway threat. Now, JoJo Townsell, the receiver there, is going to be one of 2 key receivers, Derek Holloway on the left, Townsell on the right. They are both deep threats, and they have received some double coverage this year, Tim, which I think has curtailed some of their numbers, but I think you'll still see them as the key receivers today.
Let's talk about the running backs for a second. When you look at the rosters, I have to believe that Michigan has the power runners, LA has the speed.
But in John Williams, they have a runner who has both speed and power. Williams had his second best rushing effort ever last week. He rushed for 161 yards. He's one of those durable type backs who can be both an inside-outside runner, a guy that is a good nuts and bolts runner, also a breakaway threat. You look at his numbers at the bottom there, you see that he has rushed for nearly 1,000 yards this season, most of that coming in the second half of the season. LA counters with a trio. Kevin Nelson on the left is the most versatile. Kevin Mack in the middle is the power back. Mel Gray on the right is the quickest. and also the fastest.
Statistically, we have two of the best kickers in the league here today, both of them sidewinders.
Well, in Novo Bojovic, you know that you have one of the most flamboyant kickers in the history of professional football, and because of the fact that he is so incredibly demonstrative, as you see right here, we forget about the fact that fundamentally he is a very sound kicker, both short and long. His counterpart, Tony Zendejas, has come up with some of the biggest kicks in Express history and has 9 straight field goals now, just shy of a record. Ray Bentley is the key linebacker and leading tackler for the Panthers, number 50, as you see coming up to make the tackle right here. And he has been overshadowed at times by John Corker, but is their most consistent player. And Howard Carson, the middle linebacker for Los Angeles, is the leading tackler for them. He also has 4 interceptions on the year. And, Tim, he also gives them the extra dimension of leadership and experience in the secondary.
All right, so the teams are on the field. They're being introduced now. They've warmed up. The fans are ready, and so are we. It's L.A. and Michigan coming up right after these messages. So the Michigan Panthers against the Los Angeles Express today, and it is a gorgeous day for football. We've just had the flip of the coin. L.A. has won the toss. Michigan will kick off, and the Express will have the ball first. This is some of the things that we'll be looking at. Michigan, Los Angeles, having played already this year. Big, big day in that ball game, as you can see, for Bobby Hebert. 307 yards passing. And the Panthers beat the Express 24-17. 3 touchdown passes for Bobby Hebert.
And that game, you'll remember, Tim, went right down to the wire. Bobby Hebert was putting it up on the last play of the game.
Novo Bojovic will kick off. The 2 deep men, Tony Bodie, Dwayne Gunn. This is Tony Bodie. The playoffs are underway. Tony Bodie has a hole and takes it all the way out past the 35 to the 38-yard line. Clarence Chapman is the man that made the tackle, but it'll be marvelous field position for Steve Young and the offensive unit of the L.A. Express. So as you look at the lineup, Steve Young is the starting quarterback. Kevin Nelson, the running back. David Hersey, what they call the H-back. He's a motion man. Malcolm Moore, number 84. JoJo Townsell, the other receiver. And Mike Sherrod is the tight end. Jeff Hart, Mike Durrett, Mike Ruther, Wayne Jones, Gary Zimmerman are the down linemen. A young, talented offensive line for the L.A. Express. First and 10, the ball, the give inside. This is Nelson, big gainer. And boy, he just levels the man in the secondary. Goes Kevin Nelson. And he took Ron Osborne, the safety, with him. Four scheme for the Michigan Panthers. John Banasek, the down man. David Tipton and Alan Hughes. Alan Hughes starting in the place of Larry Bethea. The linebackers, good ones, Kyle Borland, Robert Pennywill, Ray Bentley, and John Corker. John Corker has missed the last 3 games with a knee injury. He is playing today, says he is healthy. Vito McKeever replaces Clarence Chapman, who was suspended a couple of games ago. Tom Moriarty, Ron Osborne, and Oliver Davis round out the secondary. It is a first down, Los Angeles.
And so Kevin Nelson, Tim, Kevin Nelson picks up the first down yardage with that 10-yard carry on the blast play, Tim.
We are just underway at the L.A. Coliseum. You're looking at a quarterback who has turned this ball club around. We talked about that and documented that in the open. This time there is not much there for Kevin Nelson. The strong, quick, little scat back out of UCLA. David Tipton and Kyle Borland are the men who made the tackle. This defensive unit for the Michigan Panthers has been banged up. It has not played as well as it did last year because of the injuries, because of the changes, and because of the suspensions that the defensive unit has had this year. They have gone to a more basic scheme than they did last year. Last year they played a lot of games up front. They would blitz, they would X, they would play man to one side, zone to the backside. A lot of times that would happen. It has not been the case the last 3 or 4 games. Second down, Young throws, incomplete. Intended for JoJo Townsell. And I should tell you that this Michigan team, after that horrendous season in the middle of the season, came back and has now won 3 of its last 4. So they come in with a little bit of momentum.
This ground level look of Steve Young throwing a quick pass to his wide receiver, JoJo Townsell, number 26, who's running a quick post pattern. The coverage there is by Tom Moriarty and Oliver Davis. The ball was very catchable. But remember, when you throw the ball high, when the man is cutting to the inside like that, he is very vulnerable. You want to keep that ball down a little bit. Steve Young's got to lower his sights.
Brings up a 3rd and 9. Malcolm Moore in motion. Shotgun formation for Young. Here comes outside pressure. He throws it across the middle to Tony Bodie. First down, Los Angeles. He has room. Tony Bodie, down deep into Michigan territory before Ron Osborne runs him out of bounds. A 20-yard gain.
We were isolated on Tony Bodie, the H-back, number 24, who's in the slot right here. He lets it clear out and then crosses underneath. It's a perfect crisscross pattern there on third and long yardage. The coverage in the secondary, first by Ron Osborne, number 23, and later by McKeever along the sidelines. That's a perfect call on third and long yardage. Steve Young is a quarterback who's noted for coming up with the big play.
John Corker, the man who put pressure that time on Young, but he read it and unloaded quickly, just like this time. Three-step drop. Malcolm Moore cannot hang on to the football. Keep in mind, the winner of this game advances to the Western Conference Championship game.
Malcolm Moore, the most pleasant surprise of training camp, didn't catch many passes at USC. He's running a quick hook pattern along the sidelines. Vito McKeever is right there. Steve Young floated that ball a little bit, Tim. And I think if he had drilled it a little bit more, thrown it a little bit more to the outside and lower with a little bit more zip, it would have been a completion.
Second down and 10, the ball on the Michigan 30. Tony Bodie in motion. Young, the give inside to Nelson, who has a big hole. Left side to the 20, to the 15-yard line. Oliver Davis makes the tackle, but Kevin Nelson, big gainer. Nelson has 7 touchdowns this year, 828 yards.
Good mixture of plays here. This is a good time to call the draw play after double motion by the H-back, and he slips the ball to Kevin Nelson right here, who had a great career at UCLA. He, of course, being the younger brother of Darren Nelson, a little bit bigger than Darren, a little bit more physical. He has been the most versatile of their running backs this year.
Kevin sat out the first game between these two clubs. That was a 15-yard pickup. He has 26 carries, or 26 yards now, and 3 carries. This time, not much there.
Kevin has 828 yards on the year. That's coming into today's game. He is one of 3 backs that they call fullbacks. Obviously, they are not typical fullbacks types, but in this offense, they refer to them as fullbacks.
You know, Cupper, LA is the only USFL team to have 4 different players rush for 100 or more yards in a game.
That because mostly of their quarterback, Steve Young.
Steve Young, Kevin Nelson have done it. Kevin Mack has done it along with Mel Gray. This is 2nd and 9. Young looks across the middle, drops it underneath. That's Scott. Scott down inside the 10 to the 6-yard line. Goes Freddie Scott.
So once again, the Express have good luck with their crossing patterns, this time going to the wide receiver, Freddie Scott, number 87. Scott is coming underneath. He's coming from left to right. After it clears out, it's a bit of a pickoff pattern in the secondary. Scott, an 11-year pro out of Amherst, who is the 4th leading receiver in Detroit Lions history.
262 receptions in his NFL career. Freddie Scott had a touchdown pass against the Michigan Panthers, a 28-yarder, the first time these two clubs played this year. 3rd and 1, off tackle to the right. Nelson tries to cut it back. John Corker makes the tackle. That's Jim Stanley, 2nd year as head coach. You know, he's faced adversity before. Last season, Michigan won only once in its first 7 weeks. He turned it around with 12 wins in the next 14 games and took his team to the first ever USFL title. It is 4th and 1. John Hadle, the head coach of the Express, sends Tony Bodie in. David Hersey comes out. They load up with Malcolm Moore and JoJo Townsell, double receivers, top of the screen. Tony Bodie on the wing in motion. L.A. going for it on 4th and 1. This is Steve Young. I think he got it.
Good effort there by Steve Young. He appears to have it, but it may require a measurement.
The down lineman on the defense made penetration. John Corker, the outside man on the right side, came in and filled, and he made the tackle. Whether he did it in time, we'll wait for the call. You can hear the response of the crowd at the LA Coliseum. They thought he had made it, but nonetheless, there will be a measurement. Awfully close. He made it by the half, a length of the pigskin.
Watch Steve Young behind the blocking of his center and two guards here on the quarterback sneak, and also pay attention to number 57, John Corker, who comes from his outside linebacker position to fill on the inside and pushes Steve Young back, but not before he had made the required yardage.
Fourth first down of this series for the LA Express offense. Darren Long, Mike Sherrod, two tight ends. This club does not like to throw inside the 10. That's not to say they won't. This is the pitch back, student body sweep. Touchdown, Los Angeles, goes Kevin Nelson. Wayne Jones through the key block, and Nelson scores.
Good call here. It's the student body left or power pitch led by the pulling guard Wayne Jones out of the University of Utah. That's what shoots Kevin Nelson to the outside, and then it's just a foot race to the corner, and Kevin is there in time. Good call. Excellent mixture of plays on that drive for the Express.
Tony Zendejas for the extra point. Boy, when he kicks it, there's not much question about it. So the Los Angeles Express look impressive with that drive. And they also take the early lead, 7-0. Michigan will have it when we come back. A gorgeous day for football at the LA Coliseum, and the Express have delighted the fans here, scoring on their first possession. The deep men for Michigan, Bobby Futrell, number 20, Albert Bentley, the flyer out of the University of Miami, number 32.
Bentley was sensational as a return man in this game the last time we covered the two teams.
Zendejas puts it 2 yards deep in the end zone. This is Bobby Futrell. Bobby Futrell has a funnel on the outside and takes it up to the 28-yard line. Right now, let's go down to our colleague on the sidelines, Ted Dawson.
Thank you, Tim. Kevin Nelson, 6 carries for 32 yards. Did you know coming in that you could run against this team?
Yeah, we thought we could run against them. We want to just get offensive linemen started, get them, you know, driving them off the ball up front, and we think we can run the ball on them, so we're going to keep trying to do that. What about
the touchdown, the sweep to the left? You tried all different kinds, up through the middle and the sweep to the left, got the touchdown.
Oh, yeah, well, we were just setting it up, probably, you know, running the ball inside, and then we had a flip outside, which I got into the end zone.
Kevin, congratulations to you. Tim?
All right, Ted. Kevin Nelson, of course, the fourth all-time leading rusher out of UCLA. Futrell's 31-yard return gives Michigan good field position up at the 30-yard line. Bobby Hebert's your quarterback. We set that line up in just a second. This is Big John Williams out of Wisconsin. Williams had 161 yards last week in the final regular season game. The quarterback, the strong-armed Cajun from Cutoff, Louisiana, Bobby Hebert. Ken Lacy is the running back along with John Williams. The wideouts, Derek Holloway and number 26, Anthony Allen, trying to pick up the slack for Anthony Carter, who's out. Mike Cobb is the tight end. The offensive line, Ray Penny, Jeff Wiska, Wayne Radloff, Tyrone McGriff, Tony Osmond. We should almost also mention that Tom Dornbrook was reactivated, signed a multi-year contract, and he is back in uniform today. We may see him. Williams, that close to a first down. Depends where they mark it. The defensive lineup for the Los Angeles Express, Fletcher Jenkins, Georgia Chica, Charles Usry and Eddie, Meat Cleaver Weaver. There are 3 sprained ankles on that down defensive front, but they say they are playing today. It is a money game. The linebackers, Danny Rich, Howard Carson, and David Howard. 3 good ones. Henderson, Drain, Mitchell, and Scott make up the secondary. They have had an outstanding season, especially in the second half when the LA Express have come of age.
That's been one of the keys, the improvement of that defensive secondary, because early on, particularly at the corners, they were suspect.
The LA defense ranks among the leaders in the USFL with 54 sacks, 28 interceptions. It's a big play defense. The numbers on Bobby Hebert. A checkered season this year. We'll talk about that and amplify in just a second. The fake to Lacy. Hebert to throw. Has time. Going deep. Incomplete. It was intended out there for Anthony Allen, number 87. Wyman Henderson, number 22, was with him step for step.
Anthony Allen, who was with the Los Angeles Express earlier this year before being traded to Michigan, is running step for step here with Wyman Henderson, the cornerback. And you couldn't ask for better coverage than that, Tim. He's in perfect position to look back over his shoulder and see both the receiver and the football.
Second and 10. We mentioned it's been a bittersweet season for Hebert with record-breaking performances. He's also had the frustration of a nagging knee injury, which Lee Grosskopf mentioned earlier. Crossbuck trap play. This is Williams, and Williams has a big gainer. Aaron Mitchell had to come out of a safety position to make the tackle. Hebert, 3,758 yards passing this year. That breaks his old record of 3,568 just a year ago.
And he had 24 touchdowns, as we mentioned. Despite all the problems that the Panthers and Hebert had personally, he wound up with some very impressive numbers on the season.
Injured his knee in week number 11. You also saw there that John Williams had a big game last week. He was the USFL Player of the Week. And this is Williams. Williams has a first down, cuts back against the grain to the 43-yard line. So Michigan now rolls into Los Angeles territory.
And this is exactly what the Panthers would like to do, Tim, as we get a ground-level look here of John Williams coming in behind his interference. He hesitates just long enough to let it flow in front of him. He gets a good block there from Jeff Wiska, number 72, and then cuts back before he's finally curtailed by a host of tacklers by the Express.
Pickup of 11 on that play, first down Michigan. Williams now 27 yards on four carries. Kerry Miller comes into the ballgame now as a running back. Aaron Mitchell fakes the blitz, now drops off back into the secondary. It looks like zone coverage for the Express. It is. Hebert to throw against it, and it's blocked at the line of scrimmage by Weaver.
That's good penetration by Eddie Meat Cleaver Weaver out of the University of Georgia. He played on a national championship team with Herschel Walker. And I think Meat Cleaver is probably the most intimidating member of the front four. Watch him coming from the left of your screen. See right there? No, it's not Meat Cleaver. It's Charles Ussery, number 79. Meat Cleaver, of course, has been one of the intimidators. You have a couple of bookend tackles in Ussery and Achika, both out of USC.
Brings up second and 10 for the Panthers. Long count by Hebert. Give inside is to Cleo Miller, and he is lassoed quickly. That time it was Eddie Weaver. He wrapped his arms, made the penetration, and took Miller down for a loss on the play.
Well, we were talking about Eddie the time before, and maybe gave him some credit he didn't deserve. That time he definitely deserves the credit. And as I was saying, he's out of the University of Georgia, where he played for Herschel Walker on a national championship team. He's the strongest member of this team, Tim. Has a bench press of 535 pounds.
Played with Herschel.
Yep.
He might have played for him at times. Third and 11, a loss of one. Terry Miller and Cleo Miller in the ballgame now. Broughton in motion. Hebert to throw across the middle, and it's incomplete, intended for Walter Broughton, who's had a rough year. He dropped at least three other passes, including a touchdown that could have won the game against Los Angeles the first time these two teams played.
These are the things that have hurt Michigan throughout the season. We talked about the drive killers, the frustrating year that they have had. Walter Broughton on a crossing pattern right there. Now that is truly hitting your man on the numbers. That ball could not have been thrown any better by quarterback Bobby Hebert, but he simply drops the football.
Bobby Hebert 0-for-3 now. Skip Johnson on the punt. Look at his average. It's healthy. His longest, 57 yards. This one will hit at the 10, roll inside the 5. It'll be close, and it goes into the end zone for a touchback. 45-yard punt. They'll have it first and 10 when we come back. Jubilation in Tinseltown with the LA Express leading 7-0 over the defending league champion Michigan Panthers. The winner of this game advances to the Western Conference Championship game. That'll be played next week.
Quarterback Mel Gray.
6 minutes, 19 seconds, first half. Mel Gray is the running back now, seeing his first action. A swing pass to Gray is number 30. And Gray has a pickup of 8 yards. It'll bring up second and 2. So the Express have been virtually unstoppable. Right now, Ted Dawson has this report.
Thank you very much, Tim. Did you ever wonder how quarterbacks remember all those plays? Well, here at Michigan, Bobby Hebert and Mike Ray have these little play charts. They put them right on their wrist. It's got 84 plays, and then all the plays are called in from the sideline, 1 through 84. That's how they do it, just like that.
Makes it easy, doesn't it?
I never used those for football, but I used them for a few exams.
I bet you did. Second and 3. But they're here, happy to hear that at the University of Utah. Mel Gray, left side, close to a first down. I think he's got it. It'll be the fifth first down of the day for the LA Express. Robert Pennywell and John Corker take him down across the 30-yard line.
Mel Gray, of course, Tim, is one of two outstanding rookie running backs out of the University of Purdue, Eric Jordan of the Oakland Invaders being the other. He was one of the guys who triggered that seven-game win streak for the Invaders after losing nine straight early on.
Los Angeles, 10-8, the youngest team in this league. 42 players on the roster of 50 are either rookies, first or second-year players. Play action. Young to throw. Does. Has a man, and it's complete to David Hersey. Another first down for L.A.
David Hersey, the H-back out of the University of Tulsa, has been an effective receiver for them, both short and long throughout the year. Here he's running an intermediate pattern. Steve Young takes his time. The protection is excellent. Hersey breaks to the outside here, looks the ball into his hands, and also is conscious of where his feet are. And this, of course, Tim, is a two-foot league. Unlike college football, where only one foot has to be in bounds for it to be a completion.
Did he have both feet in?
Very much so.
Steve Young, 4 for 6 now, 46 yards. It's his first down.
Mel Gray.
They'll give him about 2, maybe 3 yards on the carry. Mel Gray.
Tim.
John Corker, son.
We have a good look of Durrett blocking Ray Bentley, one of the players we spotlighted at the top of the show. Look how he sustains the block here. He makes excellent contact initially, and then he takes Bentley about 4 yards further downfield. Boy, they're blowing him out of there.
Second and 7. Talking to John Hadle and some of the more experienced players at the LA camp yesterday, it's complete across the middle to Darren Long. So another first down for the Express, and right now, you're right, they're just blowing the Michigan Panthers off the field.
Darren Long, the tight end, had the best single season in NCAA history for a tight end in terms of his numbers of receptions. Steve Young takes his time again. Now you see him running a deep hook pattern right in the middle. That's Darren Long out of Cal State Long Beach. His quarterback there, of course, was Todd Dillon, who is now the backup quarterback to Jim Kelly at Houston.
19-yard pickup. Malcolm Moore in motion. First down for the Express. The pitch back to Mel Gray. Nothing there. The point I was going to make is John Hadle and some of the older players were saying that even though they are much younger than the experienced defending champions, if they just maintain what they've learned all year, have technique, stick to the game plan, that they can win. Just don't get flustered. We saw that, of course, on that big block by Durrett.
They are mostly young, but they have a number of veterans who have playoff experience, Tim. And John Hadle himself, of course, is a veteran of many NFL wars. We have been informed that we can look for a bootleg to the left, and of course, no one does that better than Steve Young.
This Los Angeles offensive line has been intact now for the last 15 weeks. Zimmerman, Jones, Reuther, Durrett, and Hart. Young in trouble, but he has that escape dimension. Throws high and incomplete. JoJo Townsell was the intended receiver. Oliver Davis is the man drawing the booze. He was the guy on the coverage.
Maybe Michigan knew it was a bootleg left too, because look how Corker applies the pressure right here to Steve Young. He puts enough heat on Steve that he has to take a deeper drop than he had liked to, throws the ball on the move to Townsell, and Oliver Davis is the man who is on the coverage. See this? See how Corker pressures him, forces him to take a deeper drop? Oliver Davis is probably the best athlete in the secondary with David Greenwood out of there. Some of the fans thought that maybe Corker roughed up Steve Young after he threw the ball.
So it brings up 3rd and 9 with 2:37 remaining in the first quarter from the L.A. Coliseum. This is the draw to Mel Gray, and Mel Gray has one man to beat on the corner. He has the first down and has run out of bounds at the 24-yard line. Mel Gray!
That forward handoff draw play out of the shotgun has been effective for them in long yardage situations occasionally this season. We've also seen the Denver Gold use this play effectively. Forward handoff right there to Mel Gray, number 30, who takes an inside move first goes back to the outside. He's pursued by Mike Edwards, number 53, and finally run out of bounds along the left sidelines. Jim Stanley played for Bear Bryant at Texas A&M back in the 60s, along with some other great players who we'll talk about later.
First down, Los Angeles, going for it all. Incomplete. Knocked down beautifully by Vito McKeever. McKeever's quite a story. He came in and replaced Clarence Chapman after Chapman was suspended for two games. He's been playing well ever since.
Another look at the H-back David Hersey, number 81, a talented rookie out of Tulsa. The ball could have been thrown about 3 yards further here and a little bit deeper, and possibly with a softer looping trajectory, which would have given Hersey a chance to run away from Vito McKeever, who was closing in from his safety position.
Second down, we'll look for Mel Gray, the 4-4 sprinter out of Purdue. He was on the track team as a sprinter at Purdue, was tested here as a wide receiver before he became the running back. And this is Gray. Not much. John Banasak made the penetration and tripped him up.
Tim, it's fun to watch Steve Young go to work, and he's engineered two impressive drives so far. I think he's probably the best athlete to ever play the quarterback position at BYU. Of course, they've had some great ones going back to Virgil Carter. Then, of course, there was Gary Scheide. Gifford Nielsen came along. Mark Wilson was next. Jim McMahon followed him. But I think of all of those, that Young is the best athlete to ever play for BYU.
From the 25, a big third and 11 situation out of the shotgun formation. Young with time, has a receiver, and it's intercepted. Intercepted by Ron Osborne, who brings it back to the 22-yard line. So Steve Young, who tried to go to JoJo Townsell. Townsell was open for a split second, but a fine read by Ron Osborne, who came up and made the pickoff.
This is uncharacteristic of Steve Young, who is normally one of the most accurate passers you will see. Now, he doesn't throw this ball in front of the receiver. He throws it behind the receiver. And in perfect position right there is Ron Osborne, number 23. JoJo Townsell was the intended target.
So Michigan dodges a bullet. Ron Osborne makes the big play in the zone defense, and now the Panthers have the football. Well, the Los Angeles Express looked like they were driving for another touchdown before Ron Osborne made that interception. It is his first interception of the year. He had three last season. We've got 1 minute, 20 seconds remaining in the first quarter. This is Ken Lacy. Ken Lacy goes around the left side for a gain of four, maybe five, before he's knocked out of bounds by Edward Scott. Ken Lacy, of course, has signed the future contract with the Kansas City Chiefs of the National Football League, and that's where he'll play next season.
He was booed at home initially, right after the signing of that contract. But the boos wore off as he began to perform again. He has certainly not had the kind of year he had in 1983, but he's still a talented player out of the University of Tulsa. I covered him there in 1981 in the ball game against Drake, and he was awesome that day. It looked like a track meet.
Well, they've used him differently this year, in all fairness to Ken Lacy. He's the power runner between the tackles. John Williams has picked up the outside responsibility as the speed back. This is Williams on the trap. Cuts against the grain. Has a first down. Looks for a block. Williams, 50. To the 45-yard line in Los Angeles territory.
Tim, this is vintage Michigan. This is what they do so effectively. Underneath ball handling here, forward handoff to John Williams. Good block there by Jeff Wiska, number 72, springs him. But he cuts back across the grain, traverses the field, does a little juke step, limp leg back to the outside, and now it's a foot race with Wyman Henderson, number 22, as he heads back to the right sideline. Let's watch Jeff Wiska's block, number 72, on Howard Carson, number 54, the middle linebacker. Good contact right there, high and hard. That sets it up for Williams to traverse back to the right.
The fake to Williams on first down and the throwback. Oh my, here we go. Michigan has a first down. So Ken O'Neill, who was recently signed by the Michigan Panthers and activated, makes the catch. First time we've seen him in a game this year that we've done.
Ken O'Neill is another country heard from. Brand new at the tight end spot. Of course, Mike Cobb has been their starter throughout the season. Finally had that consecutive game streak snapped. Cobb had caught a pass in every game up until a couple of weeks ago. I've always liked this tight end screen, and it's the throwback screen. And if you can remember way back when Y.A. Tittle used to throw this play so effectively, I've always liked the rollout throwback screen.
First down again for Hebert, who this time has time to work and looks deep into the corner. Incomplete. Knocked away nicely by Anthony Allen, or intended rather for Anthony Allen, and knocked away nicely by Wyman Henderson.
Very end of the last play, you can see number 87, Anthony Allen there, battling with Wyman Henderson, number 22, in the end zone, and the ball is swatted away adroitly there by Wyman Henderson. He one of several talented players out of the University of Nevada, Las Vegas.
So it's second and 10 from the 29 for Bobby Hebert. Looks like a zone defense by Los Angeles. No, it's a man defense, so they throw to the flat to the Iceman, Ken Lacy.
From the ground level, you can see this ball is slightly overthrown. I think it is possibly catchable, but you see Hebert threw this ball just a little bit high. However, I think Lacy should still catch it. I think that Lacy mistimed his jump. If he had just taken two more steps, he wouldn't have needed the jump. He misjudged the pass.
Looked like he was looking for the defender to come up and hit him, and he got those alligator arms. He pulled him back in, those very short arms. Third and 10 from the 29. Hebert has a man. It's incomplete. It was intended for Ken O'Neill. Out of Idaho State, 6'1", 219-pounder. Ken O'Neill was sidelined with a knee injury until the 16th game of this year. Played his first game against Oakland. Caught one pass there, and we haven't seen him in the games that we've done. He has one reception, 16 yards for the year. So, Ken O'Neill getting some playing time, and that's the end of the first quarter. Los Angeles leads Michigan 7-0. However, the Panthers have shown signs of life, and the crowd's enjoying it. We are at the Los Angeles Coliseum, and the Coliseum is taking on a new look as they prepare for the 23rd Olympiad, which starts in just a couple of weeks. That one of those statues, the model was Terry Schroeder, who is the captain of the water polo team. Water polo, of course, has a great shot at the gold medal. This is Novo Bjovic from 46 yards. It is long enough, and it's no good. Novo, 7 of 9 from that range this year. Now make it 7 of 10, and he is upset.
Novo Bojovic, who is normally very consistent as a long-range kicker, gets the ball. The ball is placed down here. He seems to have plenty of time. And as Tim Brandt told you, it was long enough, but it was wide to the left. He hooked it a little bit. Watch his reaction, and you can tell right about here, he thinks that he has hit it well enough, and then he sees the ball fading to the left, and you see the look of disappointment on his face right there.
He didn't get the best snap out of his center, David Tipton, but Novo Bjovic, who's having a better year than he had last year, better percentage, more points, misses that one. The score remains the same. Novo Bjovic, having missed the 46-yard field goal attempt, hands the ball back over to the LA Express. It's been a balanced attack here. This is Steve Young on the option play. Young picks up 5. Outstanding ball carrier.
Tim, what's interesting here as we look at the bottom line is that Michigan, normally a top time of possession team, was dominated by the Los Angeles Express, particularly that first drive in which Steve Young moved the team down for a touchdown, was impressive. So it's 9:17 to 5:43. I think that's going to be important for the Express today because in addition to being a big play team, they have emerged as a good time of possession team here in the latter part of the season.
Pitch back to Nelson. This time they come the right side. There is a flag down. I think that play prior to this one was a broken play.
Yes, it was. I agree with you.
Steve Young has made a tremendous difference on this club. You can just see the way that the club goes about its business. Goes about its business on offense. Double the point production after the first 6 games. He's played the last 12. They average now 23 points a game. It is a face mask penalty against Michigan.
Face mask, number 52 on the defense. First down.
That's Kyle Borland, who's guilty.
Kyle Borland, the linebacker, grabs number 24, Tony Bodie, right there. Tim, it doesn't take a Phi Beta Kappa to figure this one out.
It's the first penalty of the game. 13:57 remaining in the half. Hersey in motion. Play action. The pass is to Hersey. Hersey can't beat the defender on that side. Now he does on a second effort and picks up the first down. Tremendous effort by Hersey, who beat Vito McKeever. McKeever came up, had the play made. He had Hersey stop and slipped off.
David Hersey, the H-back, is in motion from right to left. Now he slides right up the seam and then cuts to the outside. You see the ball thrown a little bit behind him. Ron Osborne, number 23, the safety man, comes up to there. He gives him a little limp leg, and it's number 36, Vito McKeever, who ultimately knocks him out of bounds along the left sideline.
JoJo Townsell to the top of the screen. Malcolm Moore in motion. First down, pass is overthrown, intended for Townsell.
It's complete to Whit Taylor. Whit Taylor, number 10, along the sidelines. Watch Steve Young's form here, and maybe we can pick up why he overthrew the ball. He doesn't finish quite enough. He throws the ball with a little bit too much of a loop. However, since the coverage was there along the sideline, it was an opportune misthrow. He's now 6 of 12 in the passing department for 78 yards, and he engineered that touchdown. Those are his numbers on the year right there.
Hersey the motion man on 2nd and 10 from the 45. This is Nelson. Nelson cuts back inside, and he pays the price for that decision.
He is a good north and south runner, however, though, Tim. He can juke you, but he can also be a power back for them. And as I said at the top of the show, of the three running backs that we talked about, Nelson, Gray, and Mack, I think probably Kevin Nelson is the most versatile, meaning that he can do more things as a runner and as a receiver.
Tony Bodie comes in now as the H-back. He's out of Montana State. Bodie, a role player now. The H-back is more like a tight end. They use him in several different positions. Here they use him as the split out twin receivers, bottom of the screen. Michigan now in a dime defense, which means six defensive backs. Young, five-step drop, going deep. Incomplete. It was intended for JoJo Townsell. Outstanding coverage out there by Oliver Davis.
Tim, we mentioned that with the absence of David Greenwood, Oliver Davis has emerged as the best athlete in the secondary for Michigan. He has step-for-step coverage right here with JoJo Townsell along the left sideline. Steve Young throws the ball about as far as he can right there, and the ball is up for grabs, and no one comes down with it.
So Jeff Partridge will punt the ball for Los Angeles. He has close to a 40-yard average. His longest, 75. Tremendous roll. Going for the sidelines, but it's a short kick. It's taken by Anthony Allen, and there's not much return. I'm not so sure what he tried to do with that punt. It almost looked like he went for the sidelines, missed it, and it was a low punt. It only went 26 yards, and Anthony Allen returned it. So Michigan has good field position. Thank you, Jim Lampley. Here we have Los Angeles leading Michigan 7-0. But the Panthers now have the football back at the 20-yard line. 11 minutes, 50 seconds remaining in the first half of play. This is John Williams. Good pursuit by the L.A. defense. Something the L.A. defense has been doing all afternoon. Running to the football, very active, reading plays extremely well.
Well, we talked about how this young, talented group has gotten better as the year has gone on. We said early in the year we felt the LA Express was somewhat like an all-star team. Having played in all-star games myself, I know how exciting it is when you first get with the new guys, but it takes a while to get the timing and to develop the right chemistry. I think that's happened in the late season and here in the playoffs.
John Williams now has 57 yards and six carries. He, by the way, signed a new long-term contract with the Panthers this week. And he, by the way, had a three-yard loss that time as Fletcher Jenkins, big number 90, came through and penetrated. Yeah, that play read all the way.
Fletcher Jenkins out of the University of Washington is not the flashiest player the Express have, but Tim, he probably has emerged as the most consistent of their down linemen at his defensive left-end position. And you see right there getting through a block and coming up to nail John Williams for a loss.
I mentioned Fletcher Jenkins had a sprained ankle. He rested that ankle last week. injured against Oklahoma. He looks pretty good, pretty quick to hit it today. Third down and 12 for Michigan. The draw play inside to Khalil Miller. Eddie Weaver made the tackle, and what a story he is. Out of the University of Georgia, moved to end after the first five games. 12 and a half sacks, doing quite a job for that young defensive line of the Express.
And, of course, the man he tackled right there was one of the best ground gainers in Cleveland Browns history, Cleo Miller.
Skip Johnson on to do the punting. Wayne Gunn will let it hit. And it gets in a Los Angeles bounce, and it bounces back up near the 44-yard line. Don Echols downs it there. So the score remains the same. We've got 9:32 left in the half. 9 minutes, 24 seconds left in the half. Los Angeles has the football, first and 10 from the 44-yard line. This is the pitch back to Mel Gray. Mel Gray, speedster out of Purdue, runs into Robert Pennywell. Total mismatch. Pennywell, 225 pounds. Mel Gray, just a little guy, 175 pounds. Right now, let's go down quickly to Ted Dawson.
Thank you very much, Tim. Bobby Hebert, the offense sputtering right now. What's going on?
Well, you know, we mixing it up pretty good. We were running the ball well, and we missed a couple of passes. The last time, John got tripped up, which I think would have been a good play on the second down, but we just got to keep mixing it up and put some points on the board.
Coming off kind of a bad game for you last week, are you feeling a little pressure out there?
No, not at all, not at all.
Bobby, good luck to you. Thank you very much. Bobby Hebert, Tim.
Second and 7, Los Angeles. Bodie goes to the wingback position. Plenty of time. Double pump. Steve Young throws long. Has Townsell, and Townsell makes the catch. He makes the catch in the long jump pit down near the 20-yard line.
Tim, the book on Steve Young is that he is not a deep passer, but he threw this ball almost perfectly. Now watch as Townsell goes into double coverage. Number 36, Vito McKeever, is the short man. The deep man coming over, number 23, is Ron Osborne. He gets that ball right in between the two defenders, and it had to be thrown exactly where it was. Young now 7 of 14 in the passing department for 110 yards. That might be one of the best passes I've seen him throw all season.
That one for 32 yards. It's first down at the 20. Los Angeles in motion again. This is the sweep left, Mel Gray. There's penetration and an outstanding play by Larry Bethea. Bethea, who was replaced in the lineup by Alan Hughes because Bethea was late for a meeting this week, comes into the ball game and makes the big play. Just defeated Gary Zimmerman.
Larry Bethea, who leads the team in sacks with 11 and has made 43 solo tackles on the year, he's number 79. He gets rid of his blocker right there, penetrates, grabs Mel Gray, number 30, by the jersey and ropes him down. How did you like the play there, Coach? You're the former defensive man.
Well, right now, I'm more concerned with the other side. David Tipton just left the field cover. He looks injured. Defensive captain. We'll keep an eye on that. Three-step drop for Young. Throws incomplete. Oliver Davis was the defender. JoJo Townsell was the receiver.
Watch the punishment that JoJo Townsell, number 26, takes. He's in the slot. He's coming up the seam. And the ball is thrown a little bit high. That ball could have been thrown lower and on the numbers. That gave Oliver Davis a chance to really give him a shot because he was in a very vulnerable position because of the high throw.
It gave Davis the opportunity for the shot, gave JoJo Townsell a headache. 7:34, first half. 7-0 Express lead. Shotgun formation, third and 12. Sweep. Big play by Steve Young.
One of the concerns of Coach John Hadle is that Steve Young runs like a running back and not like a quarterback. This time it was a good thing to do. He sees the opening right there. Now he sprints for the sideline, drops his shoulder, gets under the tackle. Carlton Rose tries to take a swipe at him. But Steve Young gets underneath at 12 yards as he picks up the first down.
The key to that play was number 57 on the defense, John Corker. He lost containment, had a breakdown, and once the corner was open, Young took it for the first down.
Good point.
First and goal from the 10. Mel Gray to the 5-yard line. John Corker, Ray Bentley make the tackle. Now Carlton Rhodes is hurt. He's the man who came in and replaced Corker when Corker was hurt the last three games. 4 sacks in 3 games, 13 tackles, 6 assists, and a pass deflection.
Carlton Rhodes is a player they think has great potential, Timmy. It'd be unfortunate to lose him now.
Well, he's played some marvelous football over the last 3 games. Second and goal from the 5. The I formation has Tony Bodie, the up back. Mel Gray is the I back. The fake to Gray. Corker misses containment again. The throwback, touchdown Los Angeles. Mel Gray. But there is a flag.
Looks like it's going to go against the Express, Timmy.
It is, and you can hear the reaction of the crowd. A 4-yard touchdown pass. Young to Gray is nullified.
Offense, number 72, building it downfield. Loss of down, third down.
Jeff Hart, number 72, the tackle for the Express, was illegally downfield. So it cost his team a touchdown. That was a great extra effort there by Steve Young as he bootlegged out to his left, slipped away from John Corker, and then threw to Gray in the end zone. Looking again, watch Steve Young's extra effort here. He bootlegs, and now John Corker appears to have him. He jumps out of the grasp of Corker and then throws to Mel Gray in the end zone.
Jim Stanley has made the move. He's replaced John Corker with Mike Edwards, number 53. This looks like the halfback option. It is. The receiver's open. The ball's overthrown. Mel Gray was throwing to JoJo Townsell, who was open.
Mel Gray has got to be sick because he executed the play perfectly up to a point and then overthrew JoJo Townsell in the end zone. Now, he's an actor first. Watch this. He's got to fake the run. He's got to sell the run right now. Now that brings everybody up. JoJo Townsell is wide open, but he overthrows the ball by about 2 or 3 yards. The closest man on the coverage was Vito McKeever.
Tony Zendejas, who has hit 9 straight field goals, will try a 32-yarder. The snap is good. The hold is down. And the kick is through. So the Los Angeles Express have scored again. With 6 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in the first half, the LA Express lead Michigan 10-0. Los Angeles is certainly doing that. Expressing itself clearly. Zendejas to kickoff. Bobby Futrell and Albert Bentley are the deep men for the Panthers. This is Bentley. 4.5 yards deep. Looks for help. Now cuts across the 20, has an opening to the 29-yard line where Michigan will have the ball first down. It was Darryl Petillo who came up and made the tackle at the 29. So with 6:19 remaining in the half, that 34-yard return gives Michigan good field position.
Tim Lampley again in New York. Former Ohio State defensive back Garcia Lane has been a key figure for the Philadelphia Stars this year. Now Lane has come up with the big play, which has given the Stars a 14-0 lead over the Generals. This, a 70-yard punt return. Watch the excellent block by 84 Herman Harris that allowed Lane to go on into the end zone. And after that 70-yarder, first touchdown punt return in Philly history, they lead New Jersey 14-0. Let's go back to Tim Brandt.
All right, Lamp. So New Jersey won last week. Now Philadelphia retaliating rudely in the city of brotherly love. 6 minutes to go in the half here. Javier Bears the quarterback, and he's trying to go deep. Intercepted by Los Angeles. Edward Scott, number 23, in the hip pocket of Derek Holloway all the way. Read the pass, took it at its highest point, and made the interception.
Edward Scott, who was a starter early in the year, lost his job because of an injury, is back now. And watch how he covers right here. Perfect.
So Los Angeles gets the ball back after the big turnover. We've got 5:49 in the half at the Los Angeles Coliseum. Scott got ripped by Tremaine Johnson. Seven catches, 149 yards last week. Percy in motion, first down. Young goes to the man underneath the coverage. That's Malcolm Moore.
Well, Tim, I apologize for my comments on that last replay. If I seemed a little incomplete, I was hearing everything twice when we came back from the network.
I had the same problem. Sounded like we were in the Grand Canyon. We've got 5 minutes left in the half. Rose, Corker, and Tipton are all out now in the defensive unit that is banged up for Michigan. Moore in motion. Second and short. This is Tony Bodie. Bodie drops the football, and Michigan says it got it. So does the referee. So the referee, Bill Parkinson, says that Michigan gets it back. The Panthers, -7 in the giveaway takeaway, have improved that mark just a bit. They get the football back in good field position.
Another look at the fumble. We've got Tony Bodie, the H-back, carrying the ball on some underneath ball handling. Robert Pennywell, number 59, is the man who gets the hit. And it's Ron Osborne, the safety man, number 23, who covers it. That's the first big break of the day for the Panthers.
Los Angeles, second turnover of the afternoon. But it gives Michigan outstanding field position. This is John Williams. He cuts against the grain, picks up maybe a foot. Eddie Weaver punished him for cutting back against the defensive pursuit.
Give an assist also to number 90, Fletcher Jenkins. They really sandwiched John Williams right there as he tried to cut back. Spoke earlier about this man, Jim Stanley, played for Bear Bryant at Texas A&M back in the 50s. Also on that team, Tim, were some talented players. Jack Pardee was there at the time. So was Charlie Krueger, and so was Heisman Trophy winner John David Crow. All played for the Bear.
Second down and 10. The fake inside, the little loft pass to Lacy. 35, 30, to the 27-yard line goes Ken Lacy. Wyman Henderson is the man who knocked him out of bounds and saved what could have been a touchdown.
Ken Lacy, who misjudged one of these floating patterns earlier today, judges this one perfectly. You remember earlier, he jumped too soon. This time he sees the ball thrown a little deep. He takes the extra steps, looks back over his shoulder, makes the over-the-shoulder catch, and races along the sidelines before he's finally run out by number 22, Wyman Henderson, the cornerback. Hebert now 2 of 9 in the passing department, off to a slow start for only 34 yards.
Holloway comes to the bottom of the screen. The top of the screen is Anthony Allen. First down. Straight ahead goes Terry Miller, number 43. Well, tempers flare a little bit, and down in the middle of that, Donnybrook, is Tyrone McGriff. So McGriff and Howard Carson, two longtime NFL players, have a few words.
When does a scuffle turn into a Donnybrook?
Oh, I guess about the second little punch.
You know all about those Donnybrooks, don't you? Being a former linebacker, Ben Rover back.
Very clean player, not didn't get into many of those tussles.
I heard all about you.
Second and 7 from the 24-yard line. Miller picks his way, lift legs down inside the 20 to the 17-yard line. Well, Jim Stanley's pulling out all the stops. He's playing Terry Miller. Terry Miller, of course, was hurt most of the second half of this season. Scored 2 touchdowns against Denver, and he looks to be midseason form again.
Of course, he had a great career at Oklahoma State, where Jim Stanley coached. One of the most prolific rushers in Big 8 history when he was there.
Only has 162 yards for the year and 4 touchdowns. Third down, called 1.5 yards. Everybody in tight, 2 setbacks, the give, straight ahead, left tackle, has a hold, down to the 10-yard line goes Terry Miller. Well, what Jim Stanley's doing here, I think Lee Groskopf is going with his most experienced players in a playoff game.
He's going with the players who have the most experience, and he's also using the concept of fresh backs. That's something we've seen him do throughout the season. And when you have guys who are nearly equal in talent like that, on a hot day like that, it's a good thing to do.
Joe, can you hear me?
Well, it's good to see Terry back in the ball game. He's an outstanding individual. Told me he wants to get into broadcasting. Right now, he's doing the talking on the field. 16 yards and 3 carries, and they are about to score on Los Angeles. So both teams have had a breather at the 2-minute warning. Los Angeles leads 10-0. Keep an eye on Terry Miller. He held a Big 8 career rushing record until Rozier broke it last season. 16 yards rather, 3 carries. Long count by Hebert. This is John Williams. Has a hold. 5. 3-yard line. John Williams.
Great block there by number 72, Jeff Wiska, who we've seen making some outstanding blocks previously. That's what sprung John Williams and put him into the seam. Sweep, power sweep play. Good block right there by Cleo Miller. There's number 72, Wiska, kicking out on Dwight Drain, number 33. And it's Aaron Mitchell, number 34, who finally makes the tackle just short of the goal line.
Brings up 2nd and 2. Keep in mind, they can get a first down without scoring a touchdown. Cleo Miller, touchdown Michigan. And the Panthers right back in it. 2-yard touchdown for Cleo Miller. So it's Miller time.
This is a clinic, Tim. Watch this. If you want to see the way to run the off-tackle blast play right there, number 33, Cleo Miller, gets right in behind Mike Cobb, number 89, and John Williams, number 40, who was the lead blocker on the play.
I'm sorry.
There was a hole big enough that either one of us could have run through there.
That's Cleo's first touchdown of the year. You know, he played 9 years in the NFL with the Browns and the Chiefs. Obiovich for the extra point. Obiovich cuts the lead to 3. Novo now 47 of 48 extra points this season. He closes the gap. It is now 10-7. The Express have the lead. We have 1 minute and 50 seconds left. The drive by Michigan, 45 yards, 7 plays after the fumble by Tony Bodie.
Impressive drive. Good variation there. A lot of mixture of plays. But particularly they were impressive with their running game as they continued to bring fresh backs into the ballgame.
Biovich, long kick. Wayne Gunn, 4 yards deep. Is going to run it out to the 10, the 20, up to the 30-yard line. They'll mark it on the 33-yard line. He is lassoed there in a gang fight, but a good return by Dwayne Gunn. Gutsy return.
Dwayne Gunn, who we saw run 77 yards with a punt return against Oklahoma a few weeks ago. Dwayne Gunn, of course, is a rookie out of the University of Indiana, where he played both for Lee Corso and Sam Weiss there. Tony Bodie is the guy who gets the block right here. Look at the hit right there. Oh, he really knocks his man over. That gives Dwayne Gunn, number 83, a little bit more running room, so he takes it up and gets out of bounds to stop the clock.
You know, last year in the playoffs, the Panthers trailed Oakland 7-0 in the first half. They came back to win that one 37-21.
I remember I covered that game last year.
Here they've cut the lead to 3. Steve Young has 1 minute and 42 seconds. Bad snap. Makes a great play on it. Throws under the coverage and it's intercepted. Ray Bentley looking for a block. Runs like a fullback and takes it down to the 33-yard line. Third turnover for the Express.
Steve Young might have been better to not try to throw this because he had a very high snap from center. And this throws off the timing. Watch this right here. Now Steve Young has to leap to get the ball. Throws downfield. He's aiming for David Hersey. See how high the snap is? This throws off his timing. He's rushed. He rushes himself right here. He's aiming down the middle, trying to hit Malcolm Moore, it is, number 84. And it's Ray Bentley, number 50, who we spotlighted at the top of our show, who makes the key interception there.
Steve Young was rested in what turned out to be a meaningless game last week against Arizona. He could be a little bit rusty. 1 minute, 32 seconds remaining in the half. Hebert has a man open. It's Lacy, first down, Michigan.
He was rested because of bruised ribs. He took a real shot in the back in the game we covered against Oklahoma.
Bentley made the interception right now. He's with Ted Dawson.
Bentley may have turned this game around. What was going on out there?
Well, he kind of bobbled the snap on a shotgun. I held and then dropped back, and he tried to throw it over the middle. And I went to hit the guy, and the ball ended up in my hand, so I took off.
You were as surprised as anybody, huh?
Yeah, I was.
Hey, I did. That's the story from here on the field, Tim. Ray Bentley.
All right, Ted, thank you very much. 1:25 left in the half. You see the time in the bottom of the screen. It is first down, Panthers. Good field position. Well within Novo Bojovic's range. Michigan wants the lead at halftime. Lacy, touchdown, Michigan. Ken Lacy. Bobby Hebert threw a dart right on the money to Ken Lacy. Touchdown, Michigan. And the Panthers now have the lead.
It appeared that Howard Carson, who was on the coverage, was not even looking. It looked like if he had turned around, he might have been able to knock the ball down.
22-yard touchdown pass from that man, number 11, Bobby Hebert.
Bobby Hebert looking for Ken Lacy, who is circling out of the backfield. Lacy is on the far right of your screen. He's going to be running step for step with Carson. See what I said? Carson wasn't even looking. Had he turned around, he could have knocked that ball down or intercepted it. But he was looking at Lacy instead of turning back and catching the football out of the corner of his eye.
Novo Bojovic puts the extra point through. And all of a sudden, the Michigan Panthers, after two interceptions and a fumble recovery, have the lead, 14-10. You know, that linebacker is supposed to be reading the eyes of the receiver. When he looks back, you should know the ball's coming.
Ken Lacy. So let's pay attention to Howard Carson. First watch Ken Lacy, who is the halfback circling out of the backfield here. He's running a circle fly pattern. See that? Carson didn't watch the eyes of Lacy and therefore didn't turn back. The other man on the coverage was number 33, Dwight Drain, the safety man. Excellent pass, though, by Bobby Hebert. He put it exactly where it had to be.
Ken Lacy separated his shoulder against Denver, missed four games, was not the same after that, so many said, back in the Motor City of Detroit. He signed that contract with the Kansas City Chiefs to play in the National Football League next season. But he looked pretty tough on that pass. Michigan has scored twice now in the last 31 seconds.
How quickly a game can change with big plays. And how costly turnovers can be.
1 minute, 19 seconds. Remain in the half. Everybody to one side. Nobody expects Novo to kick it away. Clarence Chapman recovered an onside kick against Los Angeles earlier in the year. See what happens here. Now they come back into a normal formation. Everybody shifts. They get in their lanes normally, and Bojovic kicks it away. Tony Bode at the goal line. To the 20, and he's nailed. Tony Bode is nailed by Mike Edwards, the linebacker.
With 1:13 remaining here, Tim, it'll be interesting to see what approach Los Angeles takes. I think they will try to move the ball downfield and score.
Plenty of time.
Yeah. Steve Young is the type of guy that can do a lot with a minute and 13 seconds.
Wonder if he feels any extra pressure now, this being his first professional playoff game, and he's thrown two interceptions.
Well, I'm sure he feels the pressure. But he's played in big games before at the college level.
Michigan shows blitz. Corker comes backside, drives down close to Young. Young does throw a little flare pattern at to Kevin Nelson, who has running room, and a first down. Bobby Futrell came up and could have stopped what looked like it may have broken for even farther than that.
You know, you just mentioned Steve Young. We saw him in our rearview mirror this morning. He followed us into the Coliseum, and he looked like he had a game face on. Did you notice that? He looked a little tense.
Driving looked good.
Yeah.
This is Young again under pressure. Tries to get out, does. Nobody does that escape better than Young, and he's buying plenty of time. Now looking deep, unloads. intended for Townsell, who just knocks it down. He was surrounded by three defenders. Vito McKeever was the man that was there, number 36, along with Bobby Futrell. And it looked like Townsell just knocked it down to alleviate the interception.
John Corker, who was pulled from the game earlier after he had a couple misses on Steve Young, is the man applying the pressure here. He, of course, was the USFL Defensive Player of the Year in 1983. Look at this. You used the term escape dimension, and that's exactly what it is. He moves forward. He moves left. He moves back to his right. He buys more time here. Looks downfield. Bethea's chasing him. Finally, he gets the ball off. Now the clock shows 48 seconds.
Second down. This time they look at Nelson, incomplete. Nelson just let the ball go when he felt the pressure coming backside. Could have been a good move on his part rather than accepting the loss.
That's one of the plays that they'll use from time to time. And in the concept of possession passing or a ball control passing offense, Tim, that's just like a long handoff. It's a quick screen out in the left flat. And what it does is it creates an immediate open field situation for a back like Kevin Nelson, or particularly Mel Gray has been effective with that play.
With 43 seconds left, if we're playing defense now, we loosen up. We go to a prevent defense just to don't try not to allow anything deep.
So the best passes usually are underneath the coverage.
They'll play soft all the way around. Percy in motion. Young double pumps, reloads, looks for the screen, now throws back. This is Nelson. Breaks a tackle from Corker, has the first down. He's up to the 47-yard line, but there is a flag on the play.
Flag is down, and when you take that much time, it often means illegal man downfield. Let's see.
So the penalty is against Los Angeles. They'll move him back, and that'll mean it'll be punting time. Jeff Partridge, number 16, is on the field. Bill Parkinson, our referee. Here he is with the declaration.
In the offense, loss of down, fourth down.
That's what it was, illegal man downfield, which means that you can't pass the neutral zone before the ball is caught.
It also means that with 31 seconds left, Partridge to punt it. And he's deep in his own territory inside the 10. Michigan will get outstanding field position, and a good return could set up Novo Biovich again. But we won't get it. It'll be a fair catch by Walter Broughton. And now with 24 seconds left, the offense comes on, a 45-yard punt. Philadelphia working over New Jersey. Well, the Generals won that game last weekend.
The Generals beat Philadelphia twice during the regular season. But that doesn't surprise me too much that they're taking charge of that game. I had a feeling that Philadelphia was going to be the team to beat in the playoffs.
Let's go down on the field to Ted Dawson. Ted?
Thank you, Tim. Carlton Rose, the head of the defense, who was injured earlier in the game. It looks like there's a whole different spirit over here on this side of the field.
We're getting a couple of turnovers. We're having a couple of those in a couple of weeks now. And it's the offense moving the ball right now. Defense gelling, so just got to keep it up now.
Carlton Rose, congratulations. We still got another half. Right. Timmy?
And we have 24 seconds in this half. This is John Williams, who stumbles across the 30 to the 31-yard line up near the original line of scrimmage.
Doesn't surprise me too much. I think the Panthers will be content to take a 14-10 lead into the locker room at halftime.
And that'll be the last play of the half. Well, not a surprising half. L.A. came out, scored quickly twice, seemed to be dominating the line of scrimmage. Then the turnovers made the difference. Two interceptions, one fumble by Tony Bodie, and all of a sudden, Michigan came roaring back with two scores, in 31 seconds. We'll be back with the halftime activities after this message and a word from our local stations.
Jim Lampley at ABC Sports Control. We welcome those of you who are watching the Panthers and the Express. And very quickly now, we'll bring you up to date on what is happening in the Eastern Conference playoff game in Philadelphia. Scoreless first quarter, very slow quarter for the Philadelphia Stars. They have now exploded in the second quarter to completely take control of their game against the Generals, who are the only team to beat them during the regular season. Early, it was a 10-yard touchdown run for Kelvin Bryant that made it 7-0 Philadelphia. Then just moments after that, Garcia Lane gathered in this punt off the foot of Bob Grupp, and behind a good block downfield by number 84, Herman Harris on the punter. Lane went in for the 70-yard touchdown punt return, first touchdown punt return ever in the history of the Philly Stars, and they led 14-0 at that point. Kelvin Bryant was minus 3 yards in the first quarter, but came up with a big second quarter, including this excellent 11-yard touchdown catch from Chuck Fucina, who completed all six passes he threw in the second quarter. New Jersey has been able to move the ball, but has not been able to take advantage of scoring opportunities, so right now they've just gone to halftime, and the Philadelphia Stars, who had the league's best record during the regular season and are hoping to prove once and for all that they're the best team in the USFL, have a 21-0 halftime lead over New Jersey. We'll be back with more United States Football League halftime coverage immediately after this.
This is the first time Michigan has led at halftime since their May 6th game at Houston, when they had a 14-7 advantage. Tony Zendejas of Los Angeles to kick off. Bobby Futrell and Albert Bentley are deep for Michigan. This is Bentley, 5 yards deep. Out to the 20, breaks a tackle. Out to the 25, to the 30-yard line, but there is a flag. Our referee, Bill Parkinson, tells us that there was holding by the Panthers. There are the officials for today's game. The winner of this game advances to the Western Conference Championship. However, if Los Angeles wins today, they will not have the home field advantage next weekend.
62, doing the return, holding. First down.
Number 62 is Tom Dornbrook. Los Angeles has forfeited the home field, even if they should win the home field advantage, because this stadium, the LA Coliseum, will be closed because of Olympic preparation. They cannot get into Pasadena at the Rose Bowl, and the Rams won't let them in at Anaheim. This is Ken Lacy. Has a hold. First down, Panthers up across the 30 to the 31-yard line.
Good blocking on the right side of the offensive line for the Panthers, a team that has shown that they have the killer instinct in the past. Ken Lacy gets through the hole, makes a good cut upfield. He's brought down initially by Dwight Drain, number 33, the best and most effective tackler in the secondary. Wyman Henderson, second man in, 16 yards on the play for Ken Lacy. Good gainer.
Just underway, second half, Tim Brandt, Lee Gross Cup. This is Bobby Hebert, who gives it to John Williams, and John Williams breaks a tackle and picks up a quick 6 yards on that play. Of course, the key thus far, turnovers for L.A.
Turnovers, how important they can be. 3 for the Express, only 1 for Michigan. 2 of those 3 resulted in touchdowns, and in 31 seconds, as I mentioned earlier, the Panthers have dramatically turned this football game around.
Second and a long 3 yards for Bobby Hebert. Inside is Lacy, first down, then some, cuts outside midfield. To the 40, to the 35-yard line goes Ken Lacy before Eddie Scott knocks him out of bounds over there on the far sideline.
Great blocking on the left side, and it was an opportunistic call, Tim, because L.A. had a safety blitz coming from the other side. Dwight Drain, number 33, was blitzing. You did not see that. Lacy slips by Meat Cleaver Weaver, number 61, cuts to the left side. He's brought down finally by Ed Scott, the cornerback, along the left sidelines.
The key to that play, the offensive blocking, it was a trap. There was an influence block that took the linebacker to the inside. Lacy cut outside and had a 29-yard pickup. From the 33, this is first down, and this is Miller, who rambles his way down to the 30-yard line. They'll mark it at the 29.
So Ken Lacy now flaunting his playoff form, 29 yards on that last carry. He's 3 carries now on the afternoon for 51 yards, and he caught the touchdown pass for Hebert.
Bobby Hebert had just 3 pass interceptions in the first 6 weeks. Michigan was 6-0. He had 19 interceptions in the next 8 games, and that's when everything started to fall apart. Now, in the last 3.5 games, Hebert has not thrown an interception, and Michigan has won 3 of its last 4 ball games. That's Georgia Chica, who was down. Big Georgia Chica, out of University of Southern California, 6'5", 260 pounds. There's our score. We'll be right back. Georgia. Chica has been replaced by Dewey Forte. Chica, we're happy to tell you, just had the wind knocked out of him. And he will return, although it looks a little bit more painful than that. This is second and seven from the 30 for the Panthers. Inside handoff, picks up about four. John Williams, the ball carrier.
Good news, Georgia Chica returns to the field. Of course, he's one of two bookend tackles out of USC that we've talked about. And it was his presence last year, Tim, if you remember, when they signed a Chica, they went from a three to a four-man front, and they've been a 4-3 team ever since.
11 minutes, 39 seconds remaining in the third quarter from the LA Coliseum. Third down, 3 yards for the first for the Michigan Panthers. The handoff is to Miller. Has a hole on the right side. He's out close to another first down. Eddie Weaver comes up and makes the tackle. However, there is a penalty marker down. And it's against the Panthers. Penalty free ball game in the first half. Very few penalties. We saw only three flags dropped.
Illegal use of hands on the offense, number 75, third down.
Michigan ranks 11th in the league rushing despite the experience line. However, in all fairness, injuries and changes have ruined the chemistry. You're looking at one of the rocks of that offensive line, Ray Penny.
But it was Tony Osmond, number 75, who was cited for the infraction.
Third and 13 from the 36. Walter Broughton in motion. Hebert with time, now under pressure. He wants the football, it's loose. Eddie Weaver was there first. Fletcher Jenkins was with him. It looked like Weaver might have gotten it. Jenkins, number 90, comes up with the football. Hebert sacked. Outside pressure by Weaver and Jenkins. Forced the turnover. The first sack of the game.
The first sack of the game here results in a turnover. Keep your eye on number 61, Eddie Meatcleaver Weaver, penetrating from the inside. He gets the hit on Bobby Hebert, closes in on him. It's Fletcher Jenkins, number 90, who covers the football. Another look from Hebert's vantage point. See, he's being pressured right there from the middle by number 61. That forces the fumble, and it's Fletcher Jenkins, number 90, who does it. Eddie had to beat Jeff Wiska, number 72, to get to Hebert.
JoJo Townsell, top of the screen. Down low is Malcolm Moore. The pitch back is to Mel Gray. Gray has the corner. Tries to twist away from Penny Will and can't. It's still a gain of six.
So the Express are pumped up here in the second half, and so are their fans.
The Express want to keep Michigan out of the nickel defense. They want to pick up yardage on first down. They have done that at will in the first quarter and now in the third. Only the turnovers hurt them prior to the half. 14-10 ball game. Michigan scored both times inside the 31 seconds. Again, it's Mel Gray. First down, Los Angeles. Fletcher Jenkins, the man who came up with the football on the last big turnover, right now is with Ted Dawson.
Thank you, Tim. Fletcher Jenkins, congratulations. Fletch, did you feel over here that the defense, because of all the offensive turnovers, had to turn this thing around?
Yeah, I feel that our defense had to come out and try to establish something in this game because their offense is doing pretty well. We had to come out and stop them this quarter.
Were you a little injured earlier?
Yeah, I am a little injured, but I'm just going to pray to the God that he blesses me. Go ahead and continue the game.
Okay, Fletcher Jenkins, Tim.
Fletcher Jenkins, who was working against Ray Penny, both out of Washington. This is Nelson, and he doesn't have much there. Kevin Nelson, LA's number one runner with 828 yards. Also has 34 receptions. Ran for over 100 yards twice this season.
Robert Pennywell and John Banaszak shut the door on him that time.
Nelson comes out. Mel Gray comes back in. He'll be the single setback. JoJo Townsell, Malcolm Moore, the wideouts. Hersey in motion. This is Steve Young. Has a man. It's Hersey, and he's complete down to the 20-yard line. David Hersey. Oliver Davis was the defensive back, and he's slow getting up.
This is vintage Steve Young. He's best throwing the intermediate range passes. David Hersey, the H-back, starts in motion to his right, returns in motion back to his left, goes up the left seam from the slot position, and finds an opening between the coverage there. Steve Young is right on target. Oliver Davis, number 21, appears to be hurt. He's all right, though.
Hersey's third reception for 43 yards. That one for 19, and it's now first down, L.A. Mel Gray. Stopped by Corker and Pennywell.
Mel Gray running that left side, and they like that left side because of Gary Zimmerman, number 56, and Wayne Jones, number 65. Zimmerman has emerged as one of the best young offensive linemen in the league, Tim, as a rookie.
Second and eight from the 18-yard line.
Look for a counter play to the right this time. That from our man on the spot, Ted Dawson.
Malcolm Moore and Hersey to the bottom of the screen. Townsell to the top. Here's the counter to Mel Gray, right side, and he picks up a bundle. Ron Osborne had to come out of the secondary to make the tackle, but he's up 2 yards shy of another first down. It'll bring up third and short.
Why a counterplay, Tim, and this is for the new fans out there. That simply means you make a little move one way and then counter in the opposite direction. Now watch the little counter step that Mel Gray takes first to his left and then comes back to his right. The tackle made in the secondary by number 23, Ron Osborne, who's been busy at his safety position today.
The Los Angeles offense working against the third best defense in the USFL.
Look for a slant play off the left side this time, Tim.
Hersey in motion. It's a power blast left side. Mel Gray, the ball carrier. He is up close to the first down. He may be a little bit shy. He has to get just past the 10-yard line. They mark the ball just this side of the 10.
Mel Gray's numbers on the day now, 14 carries for 52 yards.
It also brings up fourth and one. Steve Young wants to talk things over with John Hadle. John Hadle knows about the pressure of the playoff games. He's been there so many times as a player in the AFL. He won the titles for San Diego in 63, 64, and 65. We'll be back. That tells most of the story. However, the drama has built down below. It is fourth and one. Los Angeles on the afternoon, one for one on fourth down conversion. One setback, Hersey in motion. Everybody in tight. This is Nelson, right side, close. There's no indication immediately. Robert Pennywell made the indication, or made the penetration, and the tackle.
I think his initial surge got him there, Tim.
There is no signal yet from the referee. They haven't moved the chains, although the LA team seems confident they are sending in Tony Bodie into the ball game, and the Michigan defense stays on the field. And the chains will come on.
We were told that it would be 34, which is a blast play off right tackle. And as you see Mel Gray, number 30, falling in behind that right side, I thought he had the yardage, and he does indeed. His initial surge got him there, even though he was knocked back.
So, despite Tony Zendejas' perfect report card inside the 30-yard line, 6 of 6 on his field goal attempts from that range this year, they still have gone on 4th and 1 twice this afternoon.
Good point.
Malcolm Moore to the bottom of the screen. JoJo Townsell to the top. Those are your wide receivers. Tony Bodie the wing, the H-back in motion. This is Mel Gray. Great play by the linebacker number 52, Kyle Borland, who kept his outside free, maintained his leverage, and made this open field tackle.
That was an outstanding play. That was like a linebacker clinic right there, Tim. Tim, you're a former linebacker. Assess this move right here.
Well, you see number 52 taking on the blocker with his hands, trying to keep him away from the leg. Still keeps the outside free. Keeps his tail tucked for his low center of gravity and makes the open field tackle. It is a clinic.
Good assessment.
5:26 remaining in the third quarter. Los Angeles knocking on the door at the 10-yard line. They trail by 4. Play action. Young looks into the corner. Now's in trouble. He'll be sacked. It's Kyle Borland. So two times Michigan has to reach deep for the big play, and two times Kyle Borland, number 52, rises to the occasion.
We've talked about the escape dimension of Steve Young, but this time there is no escape as the door closes on the blind side. Now, in the life of every quarterback, there is always a blind side. This time it's number 52, the linebacker, Kyle Borland, is coming on a blitz. He came by Mike Sherrod, the tight end, who had the obligation of blocking for Young. That's the first sack of Steve Young today, and it is for minus 10 yards.
Third and 21. From the shotgun, it's the draw right side. And again, a big play from the linebacker. Carlton Rose made initial contact.
Controversial call on third and long yardage there, Tim. I personally don't like the call. I've always felt that when you have third in an obvious passing situation, you should put the ball upfield at least as far as the required yardage, preferably 2 or 3 yards further, so if your receiver has to come back, he will still get the necessary yardage.
It'll be a 34-yard attempt. Tony Zendejas is the kicker, and he is 8 for 9 from this range. He earlier made a 32-yarder. This time he gets a good snap. He has the distance, and the kick is good. So now it's a 1-point ball game. Los Angeles comes back and scores with 3:57 remaining in the quarter. Michigan leads 14-13.
Tim, we talked about Tony Zendejas at the top of the show. He had 9 consecutive field goals coming into today's game. He now has 11 consecutive. The USFL record is 12, held by Tim Mazzetti.
However, in the NFL, Mark Mosley's record is just about double that. This is Bobby Futrell, and Futrell has a hole after the 30. He fumbles the football, it's loose, but Michigan gets it back.
Whenever I see Bobby Futrell, I always think of Johnny Walton. He played for Johnny Walton at Elizabeth City College. We've talked about Albert Bentley and how effective he has been, or rather Bobby Futrell, number 20. And how effective he has been on returns. That time he takes a little move to inside, goes back to the outside, loses the ball momentarily, and it's covered there by number 72, Jeff Wiska, the offensive guard.
A 32-yard return with 3 minutes and 39 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Anthony Allen and Derek Holloway are the wide receivers. Ken Lacy and John Williams are the setbacks. The fake is to Williams. Hebert has a man wide open. Into Los Angeles territory goes Anthony Allen, and Anthony Allen takes it to the 41-yard line.
We were isolated on Anthony Allen, number 87, out of the University of Washington, where he was one of the most prolific receivers in Husky history. Watch what he does. He coasts it first, lets it clear out, crosses. He's wide open there, and he's going to be forced out by number 54, Howard Carson, and also Edward Scott, the cornerback, number 23. That's one of those patterns that's effective after play action. The play action is what set it up.
Allen has had 13 catches in the last 4 games. He caught 14 passes earlier in the year when he played for the LA Express. Oh my, power play, not much there. Howard Carson comes up to stop it in a hurry.
Good gang tackling by the Express.
Let's go downstairs now to our colleague, Ted Dawson. Ted?
Thank you, Tim. I thought that people at home might be interested in seeing the still pictures that the defensive coaches take from upstairs here at the Coliseum. These are the various defensive tendencies on various plays. They send them down here for the defensive team to look at to see what the offensive team to look at, see what the defensive guys are doing in the various sets. That's how complicated it is down here on the field.
You know, that was outlawed in the National Football League. George Allen started it in this league because it is legal. And now all of the teams have adopted that, and it does give a pretty good picture to the defensive personnel. This ball is bounced to Ken Lacy, incomplete.
That's a good reminder about it being outlawed in the National Football League. I had forgotten that, but I remember as a third-string quarterback with the Giants, that used to be one of my jobs. I was the relay man. I'd get those Polaroids and run them over to the coach.
What would happen if you got in the ball game? You'd be winded.
That's right. That didn't happen too often. There are a couple of fellows named Charlie Connolly and Y.A. Tittle. Kept me on the bench for about 3 years.
2:31 remaining in the third quarter. From the L.A. Coliseum, Tim Brantley, Gross Cup. Bobby Hebert under pressure. Steps up into the pocket, drills the football, but an outstanding defensive play out there by Troy West. It was intended for Terry Miller, but Troy West, the big play man in the nickel defense for L.A., played inside out and knocked it away.
I knew we'd be calling the name of Troy West before the day was over. He's out of USC. He was the last cut of the Los Angeles Rams a year ago. Hebert is throwing for Terry Miller, number 43, but Troy West has consistently been one of the best players in their secondary, even though he has only played in a part-time role throughout the season. He leads the team in interceptions with a total of six.
Skip Johnson with a 39-yard average is on the punt. Johnson replaced David Greenwood, who went out with knee surgery earlier in the year, and he shanks this punt. But it won't hurt him. It will not hurt that badly. It goes out of bounds at the 21-yard line. It was a bad snap and a bad punt. It ended 21 yards. The Express trailed by one, but it has not dampened the enthusiasm of the crowd and the cheerleaders here, with 2:19 remaining in the third quarter. L.A. has the football. Steve Young is the quarterback. Young rolls right, has Banasek breathing down his neck, and he just throws the ball away. That'll draw a flag. Well, Kyle Borland and John Banasek chase Steve Young halfway back to Alameda.
Alameda, California, where I live. Closest man there was an offensive lineman, Jeff Hart, number 72.
Well, Kyle Borland, number 52, is called for roughing the passer. Jeff Hart jumped a little bit too early, was downfield on the pass play. Illegal receiver downfield, so the two penalties offset.
Let's take a closer look. Steve Young, it looks like a broken play here. He wanted to roll the other way. Now, all of a sudden, he's in trouble. He's throwing the ball out. JoJo Townsend was the closest eligible receiver, but actually the closest man there was Jeff Hart, number 72.
Second time Hart's had that called against him today. The first one called a touchdown back. Los Angeles scored. It was nullified by Hart's penalty.
That's a good reminder. I think a lot of people have forgotten that in the first half, Steve Young had a touchdown pass called back when he escaped the grasp of John Corker and threw the ball to Mel Gray for a 4-yard touchdown. That hurt. So Los Angeles trails in the game still, 14-13.
David Hersey comes into the ball game as an added receiver. JoJo Townsend comes to the bottom of the screen. Malcolm Moore, number 84, goes to the top. Hersey goes in motion. Young drills the ball to Hersey, who has it at the 35. Picks up a block to the 42-yard line. David Hersey.
David Hersey, a talented rookie out of the University of Tulsa, Tim, is a guy we have liked in previous games that we've covered. He comes from his H-back position, runs a hook pattern here, escapes the grasp of Ray Bentley, number 50, turns back upfield, and is finally brought down in the secondary by safety man Ron Osborne, who has been very active today for them. Four catches now for Hersey for 61 yards.
David apparently recovered from a separated shoulder he had earlier in the year. Two-step drop, and JoJo Townsend drops the football. It should have been a catch.
No doubt about that one. He's running the 5-yard hook. 5-yard hook by JoJo Townsend. Steve Young hits him right on the numbers. See what he does here? He looks upfield before he has the football. Sports quiz, you can't run without the what?
The football, the pigskin, whatever you want to call it, the spheroid.
Excellent. You get A+ on that quiz.
First time I've ever passed a test.
Steve Young now 11 of 21 for 166 yards on the day.
48 seconds remaining in this quarter. The winner of this game goes on to the Western Conference Championship. This is Kevin Nelson, who tried to bounce outside but lost his footing. Larry Bethea was the man that threw him off balance. This defense of Michigan's, which ranks third in the USFL, has had its problems this year. Clarence Chapman was suspended for missing some meetings and being late for practice. Larry Bethea, John Corker were suspended at one point. Larry Bethea was benched earlier in this ball game. Did not start the ball game because he was late for a meeting. Young on third down throws, and Nelson can't hang on. So third and eight, it looks like they'll have to punt it away.
Two drop passes, those are drive killers, Tim. And you know what? This has been a very fast third quarter. And we've got a barn burner going into the fourth.
The L.A. Coliseum, the site of the 23rd Olympiad, which starts in just a couple of weeks. Jeff Partridge, number 16, is on to punt. Against Los Angeles will nullify the big play.
Unsportsmanlike act, hiding in the bench area. This game, fourth down. No loss.
Well, John Corker wants the ball right there. He wants a loss of down, but it'll be fourth down. They'll have to punt it over. The call, unsportsmanlike play on Los Angeles because the player, Wyman Henderson, came out of the bench area without reporting into the official.
Unsportsmanlike act, hiding in the bench area. That is an amazing. That's the old sleeper play. You remember the variation of the old sleeper play where you hide a guy? Now let's see if we can see. Jeff Partridge throwing from punt formation. Here's Wyman Henderson, number 22, along the sidelines, but apparently did not report to the official. He hid in the bench area, came off the field illegally. Let's see if we can get a better look at it. We can't see that he's hiding, but if he did not report to the official and came from the bench late, then it is an illegal play, an unsportsmanlike act. We still can't see that he comes from out of bounds or that he was indeed hiding in the bench area as was called by the official. But that's something, you remember when you used to play touch football, the old sleeper play, Tim?
Well, right now, John Hadle is talking with the referee, Bill Parkinson. He is extremely upset at the end of the third quarter. There's your score. The divisional playoff will continue after this message and a word from our local stations. Number 16 is on to punt it after a very controversial call, and we'll explain that right after this punt play. No fake this time. This time he gets the punt off. And it takes Walter Broughton all the way back to the 25-yard line. And it'll die right on the line. Now, Jack Pitkus, the head linesman, number 62, is the man that made the call on that last controversial call. He has talked with John Hadle. John Hadle says a player can come out of the huddle anytime and line up anywhere he wants. Jack Pitkus says he can't be within 5 yards of the bench area. Very quickly, let's go down to Ted Dawson and see if he has more on the situation.
Thank you very much, Tim. I was just talking with John Hadle. He plans to file an official protest with the league commissioner over that. He said the official is dead wrong. Henderson came out of the huddle. There's no way they can call that play. That's John Hadle's view.
All right, Ted. It is, without a doubt, the most controversial call of this ball game, and certainly one that we haven't seen made all season. L.A. tried to fake punt in the opening game, lost to Denver. That was unsuccessful after Denver diagnosed the play. Here's a flag drop here. If we get a chance, we'll try to show you the play again because it was a terribly controversial call.
John Hadle claims that Wyman Henderson, number 22, came out of the huddle. He is lining up on the left. Jeff Partridge throwing from punt formation. Henderson all alone there. And the man who makes the call is the official right behind him. You see the flag drop back there. So he was in a good position to see it. But John Hadle claims it was a legal play.
First and 20.
So Michigan is called for holding. They move it back. It'll be first and 20. It was a 33-yard pickup on that fake punt. But it was all for naught. It was nullified. The heads linesman called it back. Hebert with pressure on the backside from Weaver. Drops the ball to Lacey at the 20. Bounces outside. And is taken down at the 20-yard line.
Tim, as you look at the third quarter numbers, you can see how this game has really gotten closer. Total yards very close there, 280 for Los Angeles, 223. LA still dominating in terms of their time of possession numbers, and that's a surprise because Michigan, along with Birmingham and Philadelphia, has been one of the top TOP teams, time of possession, in the league this year. The key still, I think, three turnovers for Los Angeles.
A gain of five for Ken Lacey. It'll be third and 15. 13 minutes, 36 seconds remaining in this ball game. Michigan leads by a point. This ball intended for Derek Holloway. Daryl Petillo was the defender over there, and it was close to pass interference, but a good no call.
Daryl Petillo is covered.
This is what happens along the sideline. This is the communication they use in flashing the plays. Plays are called down, given to Whit Taylor, the backup quarterback there, who then flashes them to the quarterback on the field, Bobby Hebert. He then checks his wrist, calls the play.
Third and 15 from the 20-yard line. Bobby Hebert now faces a violent pass rush. Walter Broughton is in motion. Here comes Weaver from the backside. Hebert goes down, but he completes the pass across the middle for a first down. Walter Broughton is the man who made the reception. Bobby Hebert slow getting up. He has been nagged by a knee injury and will probably have surgery at the end of the year.
Eddie Meat Cleaver Weaver, number 61, the defensive end, is the man who applies the backside pressure on Hebert, along with number 75, Georgia Chica. Watch the pressure now as Hebert steps forward in the pocket, throws as he's going down. The target is number 24, Walter Broughton, a former running back when he was at Jacksonville State.
An 18-yard pickup. Hebert now is thrown for 111 yards. Hebert on first down throws. This time Holloway breaks the tackle, has another first down to the 40. Howard Carson, the linebacker, knocks him out there.
Derek Holloway, the little flyer out of the University of Arkansas, who was overshadowed in publicity by Gary Anderson when he was there, runs a five-yard hook and then slips back to the outside, gets away from Wyman Henderson, number 22 right there, and then Howard Carson, number 54, comes along to make the tackle. That's the first catch of the day for Derek Holloway, who we talked about at the very top of our show. Pound for pound, he is one of the strongest men in professional football. Despite his diminutive stature, he bench presses 375 pounds, squats with 580.
That 22-yard pickup moves it to the LA 40. And Miller picks up close to another first down. Michigan taking charge now. And holy gross cup, have we seen the ebb and flow of power in this ball game. First it was Los Angeles, now it's Michigan.
We thought we had a good matchup. We talked about that at the very top of the show. Michigan, a team with the experience. They have veterans who have playoff experience, guys who have been there, guys you figure are going to peak at the right time, just like they did last season. LA, of course, a bunch of great young players, maybe the best young talent in the league. But will they gel in time? We'll see.
Terry Miller, who hasn't played in quite a while, has 28 yards, five carries for the Michigan Panthers. Second and one from the 30. This is Miller, has the first down and then some inside the 25-yard line.
So Terry Miller and Cleo Miller, two backup runners, along with Lacey and Williams, they have had fresh backs in the game almost continuously since the second quarter. Miller gets the ball off the left side there. There's a good opening. And that's north and south running, meaning that he points his nose toward the goal line and goes for it.
What do you think is going through John Hadle's mind now after a successful fourth down fake punt pass for 33 yards that was nullified? Giving Michigan back the ball with 11 minutes left in the ball game. John Williams cuts back inside against the grain, breaks the tackle to the 9-yard line. John Williams, who had 161 yards last weekend, the regular season finale, and was the USFL Player of the Week.
Aaron Mitchell, in isolation from his safety position, has been not only a top interceptor for the Express, but also one of the leading tacklers on the team, and he has to come up and make the tackle on John Williams, loses the grasp, and then it's Dwight Drain who comes along to finish the job off. John Hadle, who was an All-American at two positions when he played for the University of Kansas, both running back and quarterback.
44 years old, may feel much older than that right now. Williams to the four.
So this has been an impressive Michigan drive. This is what we associate with Michigan Panther football, Tim. We saw them early in the season when they were on their six-game win streak come in and dominate the Denver Gold game we covered where they won 28-zip. And this is what they did best. Tackle-to-tackle running. Trap plays, power plays, dive plays.
John Williams now has 90 yards. He signed a series of one-year contracts for 3 years, so he'll be with the Michigan Panthers for quite a while, even though Ken Lacy now will go to the National Football League with the Kansas City Chiefs following this year. We've got 9 minutes, 43 seconds remaining in this ball game. Michigan has a one-point lead, but they're threatening again. I think John Hadle could use some of that right now with 9:43 left in the ball game.
I was thinking the same thing. It's been a frustrating day for John Hadle. He saw one of his gadget plays go awry. A touchdown pass by Steve Young was called back. What else can happen?
He knows about the pressure of the playoffs, though. He's been there so many times as a player before. This is rookie year as a head coach. John Williams, right side, looks inside, goes to the 3-yard line. Dwight Drain saved the touchdown for L.A.
Dwight Drain, a sensational rookie out of the University of Oklahoma. They think he can develop into one of the top safety men in the league. John Williams starts out on a sweep play to his right, follows his blocking. He makes the cut right here. And look who's up there from the safety position to greet him, number 33, Dwight Drain.
The Michigan offensive line now dominating. It is experienced. Ray Penny played in the Super Bowl. Jeff Wisker, the USFL championship last year. Wayne Radloff, NCAA champ, the Super Bowl. Tyrone McGriff and Tony Austin, the USFL championship. This is Hebert, touchdown Michigan. Mike Cobb, the tight end, makes his first catch of the day, and it's a touchdown.
So despite playing with a bad cartilage in his knee, Bobby Hebert is nimble enough on the bootleg play to get outside the corner and look for his target, Mike Cobb. See this little move? Just enough mobility. You can see that he's a little gimpy, but he has enough mobility to get outside, take his time, throw that nice soft pass in there to Mike Cobb, number 89, and it settles into his numbers for the touchdown. Makes that one look easy. And they set it up to him with the run.
Big extra point for Novo Bojovic because the two-point play is allowed in this league. So that point was a big one. Michigan 21, Los Angeles 13. We'll be back for the final 8 minutes and 57 seconds after this. Bobby Hebert with the touchdown pass to Mike Cobb, and the strong-arm Cajun has really come to life to bring his team up 21-13. Novo Bojovic to kick off. You see the shift. They feign the onside kick, now line up in their lanes, and they kick it away deep. This one will be fielded on a hop by Tony Bodie on the 11. And he gets it back to the 20-yard line.
Graphic on the scoring drive shows you that it was pretty much vintage Michigan. You know, they took 10 plays to go 75 yards, were able to use a 5 minutes and 53 seconds, and it culminated with a play-action pass, little bootleg move by Hebert as he rolled to his right, found his tight end Mike Cobb in the end zone. We've seen them do that sort of thing so many times over the last 2 years, Tim.
When we talked about momentum, we talked about the favorite of this ball game way back at the top of the show. We said that LA was the favorite. Lee Grosskopf said, don't count out the defending champion Michigan Panthers. And oh, have they played well. Young escapes one tackler, now looks upfield, tucks it away and gets up to the 26-yard line, and he is punished for it. Well, we're looking to see if Young gets up. He doesn't. He's slow getting up. And he's going to leave the ball game, I believe. No, he's going to go back in. He really took a lick. Kyle Borland and Ray Bentley were the tacklers who came up and really nailed Steve Young.
Steve Young looked a little dizzy, though, as he was getting up. One of the things he does so well, of course, is the scramble move, escape dimension, moves out of the pocket to his right, comes here. Now watch the collision right there. The man who gets the first hit and the hardest hit is Kyle Borland, number 52, but also applying the pressure are Tipton and Bentley.
Boy, Bentley really may have given Young a headache. Spinning, turning, driving goes Mel Gray for the first down. This is where the Young Express must come of age. Right now, here's Ted Dawson.
Thank you very much, Bobby Hebert, with a sensational drive, but I noticed you favoring your knee and holding it when you came off the field. How is it?
Well, it's hurting me a little bit. It feels like it's starting to lock up on me, but if I can keep it loose, I think I'll be all right.
Is there any question in your mind that you can continue to play?
Yeah, I can play. I just got to, play with a little pain, but the game's not over. We just got to get the ball and score again and forget it.
Bobby, congratulations to you. Bobby Hebert, Timmy?
Bobby's had that nagging injury for quite a while now on the knee. He may have to have knee surgery at the end of the season. He hopes that's not very soon. Here's the wide receiver screen to JoJo Townsend, who breaks the tackle and gets up close to another L.A. first down. You know, it's been a bittersweet season for Bobby Hebert with record-breaking performances, but he also has had 22 interceptions.
JoJo Townsell in isolation here has been Steve Young's favorite receiver since Steve joined the team in April. You see that he's running back toward Young in motion, takes a hitch pattern there, picks up a block from his center, Mike Ruther. So it's kind of a little sideline or slip screen there, which is a way to create an open field situation for a versatile receiver like Townsell.
Second and one, Mel Gray has the first down.
Mel Gray.
Question is, was that a clip by Ruther?
It looked like it might have been a clip on the previous play.
I thought so too. They were out of the neutral zone, away from the 5-yard distance.
According to Ted Dawson, we've got quite a bit of wind coming up down there on the field now, and that could be a factor here in the fourth quarter. However, right now Steve Young has the wind at his back.
Malcolm Moore comes to the bottom of the screen. JoJo Townsell to the top. 45 left in the ball game, and on first down, Young to throw. In trouble. Escapes it across the middle, and it's complete to Hersey. If he hadn't caught the pass, there would have been pass interference, I do believe. Watch Ray Bentley go piggyback on Hersey.
David Hersey, who we've talked about from his H-back position, has executed this play well. Double motion, up the seam, hooks to the outside. And here is the aforementioned piggyback maneuver that Tim Brandt just told you about. Ray Bentley, the leading tackler on the team, who we spotlighted in our pregame show, has probably been the most consistent player over the 2-year span for the Panthers.
A 6-yard pickup, it'll second and four. This is Mel Gray. Mel Gray will be a yard shy of the first.
Remember, Tim, you mentioned this while we were away, trailing by 8 points now. Should Los Angeles score, I think we can almost certainly expect the 2-point play. No one does that better than Steve Young, because when he rolls out, he has the option to run or pass.
21-13 is the score. Michigan leads with 4:35 left in this game. It is paramount now that LA maintains its composure. The pitch back to Gray, and he won't make it. Matter of fact, he loses a yard, and it'll bring up a very critical, crucial fourth down situation for John Hadle, Steve Young, and the LA Express.
Replay of the third and one situation. Percy, the H-back, is in motion. Pitch to Mel Gray, number 30. Watch the work of Vito McKeever coming up from the secondary tip, number 36. He really shut that play down.
Trailing 21-13. He's got a fourth down situation. Michigan 21, Los Angeles 13. We've got 4 minutes and 3 seconds remaining in the ball game. certainly one of the biggest plays of the game for Los Angeles.
Look for a bootleg here. Look for a bootleg here, Tim.
Fourth and one. Fourth and one. Young under pressure. Has to sprint. He has the first down. Los Angeles has new life, but Young looks like he's hurt. Steve Young, who was shaken up just two plays ago, is still down on the Los Angeles sideline. We want to welcome those of you who have been watching the New Jersey-Philadelphia game. The Stars apparently in control there, leading 28-0. Steve Young is up and back on the field.
What tremendous courage by Steve Young, who gets a real shot along the sideline. Here's the bootleg play. Mike Durrett is the man who kicks out on Kyle Borland to set it up so that he can find the seam. And watch what happens as he slides here along the sideline. Number 23, Ron Osborne, the safety man, gets a real shot on Steve Young. They've been encouraging to do the hook slide. He says, every time I do that, I get hurt.
Keep in mind, the two-point conversion is legal in the USFL. This is first down. Mel Gray sidesteps, spins, turns his way up to the 40-yard line. Now in Michigan territory. We've got 2 minutes, 54 seconds left here. Michigan leads 21-13. Early in the ballgame, Los Angeles had control and took a commanding 10-0 lead, seemingly commanding at the time. But then they had 2 interceptions and a fumble recovery. Michigan scored twice in 31 seconds, and they led at the half 14-10. There was a tremendously controversial call here in the second half. On fourth down, Los Angeles went to a trick play. They picked up 33 yards in a first, but it was called back on a penalty. This is Young, who throws across the middle. He has a man. It's his tight end, Darren Long. And he's down deep in Michigan territory. They'll mark it at the 17-yard line.
Young is hurt. Young is hurt.
Steve Young, who has been playing with pain here, you see him right there as he appears to be hurt again. On 3 occasions, we have seen him start to leave the game.
He is going to leave now, Lee Gross Cup. Frank Sire comes on. He and Steve Young having words at midfield, and Young sends him back.
Steve Young was sacked as he released the ball that time, and he went to his tight end, Darren Long, out of Cal State Long Beach. Watch the pressure applied to Steve Young as he takes his drop. It's number 79, Larry Bethea, who is the leading sacker on the team for the Panthers. That's Long, number 89, who caught all those passes from Todd Dillon when he was at Cal State Long Beach.
Young, in his first professional playoff game, is 14 of 27 for 205 yards. We've got 2 minutes now, and the Express putting the pressure on the Panthers. The winner of this game goes on to the Western Conference Championship. Los Angeles trails by 8, but the two-point conversion is an option in this league. LA is 4 of 5 in the two-point conversion this season, 3 for 3 with Steve Young. This is first down from the 17. Young, under pressure, throws across the middle, and it's dropped, but there's a flag down, pass interference. It was intended for Malcolm Moore. Ron Osborne, number 23, and Oliver Davis, 21, with the defensive backs out there covering. Steve Young, what a gutsy performance here in the fourth quarter. He was popped earlier by Kyle Borland and Ray Bentley. He was shaken up, did not leave the game. He came back 2 plays later. Osborne tagged him again. Both times, Steve Young got the first.
Number 57 will be accepted.
So, Robert Pennywell was tagged first. That penalty is declined. John Corker roughed the passer. They accept that penalty, and that'll move the ball down inside the 10-yard line.
John Corker, the USFL Defensive Player of the Year last year, is the man who comes in and hits Steve Young with a late shot. Called there for roughing the passer.
1 minute, 55 seconds remain from the L.A. Coliseum. Tim Brantley, Gross Cup.
This game has been everything we thought it might be, Tim, and more.
The Michigan Panthers, the defending USFL champion. The Los Angeles Express, 10-8 on the season, getting stronger every game. Now for Moore in motion. The give is to Kevin Nelson. There's a flag, and Nelson is taken down quickly by number 79, Larry Bethea.
Okay.
20-yarder makes a stop.
So the Michigan Panthers, good pursuit. Running to the football, and the penalty is against Los Angeles. So the Express continue to hurt themselves. We should tell you that L.A. had a touchdown called back in the first half. Jeff Hart was called for being downfield illegally.
Illegal motion on the offense, number 84, first down.
This penalty is against Malcolm Moore.
David Hersey, the H-back in motion. No, that's Malcolm Moore, number 84, in motion. He turns upfield just a little bit too early.
Four penalties, 40 yards against the L.A. Express. First down, 13 yards for the first, and the touchdown. This pass, is it cut? No good, he's out of bounds. JoJo Townsell made the catch, dragged his feet. The Marlon McKeever was the defender, and he couldn't get his feet in bounds. It would have been a touchdown. Vito McKeever, rather.
The very end of this play will give you a closer look at the call. Remember, this is a two-foot league. That means both feet must be in bounds. And it looks right there that he drags both feet and that they are indeed inside the marker there. It looks like a perfect play.
Well, they just showed the replay on the big screen here at the L.A. Coliseum, and you can hear the reaction of the crowd. So controversial calls continue to go against Los Angeles. Hersey in motion. Young, draw play, Kevin Nelson. Nelson gets back to the 12-yard line. David Tipton is the man who trips him up.
One more look at the controversial call. Remember, it's a two-foot league. There's the left foot. That's good. Here's the right foot. That looks even better.
Well, he's got white shoes on, and they're also taped. And on that white line, it's a tough call for the official.
Good reminder.
108 remaining. Third down. This is Young. He's under pressure. Escapes. Young to the 10. The 5. To the 1-yard line. Did he get in? He thinks he did. The official says no. They'll mark it at the goal line. Oh, my. Steve Young. Gutsy play. Takes it down to the 1.
Watch Steve Young get away from Carlton Rose. Watch this. No, it's number 76. John Banaszak he gets away from. Tony Bodie gets a block there. Steve Young appears to hit the flag, which is part of the goal line. That would have given him a touchdown. He thinks he's in. Oliver Davis is the man who makes the tackle, but they're calling it on the 1-foot line. Let's see if he hits the flag. He appears to.
And his hand was over.
His hand was over, but the ball was not. Remember, the rule is the ball must break the plane.
It's 4th and goal from the 1. The give. Touchdown, Los Angeles. Kevin Nelson scores for L.A. That makes it 21-19. The 2-point conversion is paramount. They follow Jeff Hart, the veteran, 5-year starter for the Baltimore Colts, and Mike Durrett. Timeout, Los Angeles. It's their last timeout. That's Jim Stanley, the concerned head coach of the Michigan Panthers.
Another look at the touchdown as Kevin Nelson slashes off the right side and cuts underneath the closing linebacker. Jeff Hart and Mike Durrett apply the block. That was a good move to go low. By going low as he did, Kevin Nelson was able to squirm into the end zone. So now Steve Young, who is 3 for 3 on 2-point plays. The Express are 4 of 5 on 2-point conversions this season. Steve Young has done it exclusively on rollout plays. So you would assume he would go with some type of rollout, sprint out, or bootleg action. That would give him the option of either running the ball himself or dropping the ball off to one of his receivers.
80-yard drive, 16 plays, took 8 minutes and 5 seconds. L.A. has gone on 4th and 1 3 different times today, and they've been successful. They now go for the biggest play of the ball game, a 2-point conversion. as Lee Grosskopf just amplified. They are 4 of 5 in two-point conversions this season. 3 for 3 with Steve Young. Mel Gray and Tony Bodie are the setbacks. Long count, fake to Bodie. The corner is open for Young. 5, touchdown, extra point, two-point conversion. It's all Steve Young. Steve Young, who made the touchdown possible with his scramble, now comes back and scrambles backside for the two-point conversion. We're tied with 52 seconds left at the LA Coliseum.
Steve Young, who learned his craft from Lavelle Edwards at BYU, looks to his right, scrambles back to his left. Watch the block by Mike Sherrod, number 86, on Mike Edwards, number 53. The two-point play.
We've got 52 seconds remaining at the LA Coliseum. Tony Zendejas is the man to kick off, the deep men for Michigan, Bobby Futrell and Ray Bentley. Short kick. Albert Bentley comes up, but it's Don Echols who picks it up. Echols to the 25, bowls his way up to the 26-yard line. So Albert Bentley never got up to have a chance to field the ball. It was Echols, the tight end. Los Angeles says it's a loose football. We told you the drive lasted 8 minutes and 5 seconds. The two-point conversion, perhaps the biggest play of Steve Young's career. The winner of this game advances to the Western Conference Championship and play the winner of tomorrow's Arizona-Houston game. ABC's coverage of the USFL continues tomorrow. Lee Grosskopf and I will be in Birmingham, Alabama for the Tampa Bay Birmingham game. Many viewers in this area will see Arizona-Houston. Derek Holloway and Anthony Allen, along with Ken Lacy and Terry Miller. Those are the skilled people, along with Bobby Hebert, your quarterback. Hebert under pressure, backside, drops it across the middle. Ken Lacy drops the football over the middle. Right now, the hero of the day, Steve Young, is with Ted Dawson. Ted?
Thank you very much, Tim. Steve Young, an incredible drive. You just kept coming, but physically, how are you? Are we going to be able to go into overtime?
I think so. A little fuzzy, but, you know, the ribs again, they got them again, but when you're in a game, it's pretty loose, so I don't think it'll bother me right now.
John Hadle tried to pull you out of the ball game, and you said, no, I want to keep going.
Well, it's just little things that you need a little break for a second, then you're ready to go again.
Steve, congratulations, a sensational drive. We'll see you in overtime.
Okay.
Steve Young, Tim?
39 seconds remain. Steve Young sat out the ball game last week at Arizona to rest those ribs and try to get them to heal. Here's the draw pad play to Lacy. And look at the emotion of 33 Dwight Drain. Quite a contrast here between Los Angeles and Michigan. Los Angeles, perhaps the youngest club in the USFL, with 42 players on the roster of 50, rookies or second-year players. Michigan, the defending USFL champion, certainly more experienced.
We spotlighted all of these particular matchups at the top of the show, and I think everything we talked about has come true. This has been an incredible football game.
Both teams now in a standoff after four quarters of quite a Donnybrook. They watch the clock tick down. Michigan on third down conversion had a big day, but they aren't going to get this playoff because time has expired. It will be overtime at the LA Coliseum. Michigan 21, Los Angeles 21. And they will now have the coin flip at midfield to see who gets the ball and when. For Steve Young today, he had 7 carries, 44 yards. In the passing department, he was 14 of 28 for 205 yards.
Of course, earlier this year, he became the first man in professional football history to rush for over 100 yards and throw for over 300 yards in the same game. That was against Chicago. According to the Alliance Sports Bureau, he's the only man in pro football history to ever have achieved that feat.
The great-great-grandson of Brigham Young.
Tail is tail, right? You're going to call? Heads. He calls heads. He calls heads?
Heads.
It's heads. Heads, you win the toss. We're going to receive. Which way are we going? Over here, Red.
Robert Pennywell, 59. Jeff Hart, 72.
Michigan wins the toss and will receive in 3 minutes.
Well, you heard our referee, Bill Parkinson, explain. The coin flip has been won by Michigan. They have elected to receive. There will be a three-minute break, and then these two teams will tee it up, line up, and go back out in the middle of the field. We've got a good old-fashioned Donnybrook. We're back at the L.A. Coliseum. Tim Brantley, Gross Cup. They have put 15 minutes on the clock. We'll play until one team scores. It is sudden death. If there's a tie at the end of the 15 minutes, we'll put 15 back, and we'll start again. This is Albert Bentley up the left side, returning the kick by Tony Zendejas. Michigan has played two overtime games this year. They won them both. Novo Bjovic kicked the winning field goal against Houston. They won that one 31-28. They also beat San Antonio 23-17. Los Angeles has been in overtime twice. They have won them both. 23-17 over Memphis, 27-24 over Houston. Tony Zendejas kicked the field goal to beat Houston. The winner of this game, I repeat, advances to the Western Conference Championship to play the winner of tomorrow's game between Arizona and Houston. Anthony Allen comes to the bottom of the screen. Derek Holloway to the top. Ken Lacy, John Williams are your setbacks. Just underway in overtime, 21-21. This is Hebert. Three-step drop pass Holloway up at the 46-yard line. And Lee Grosskopf, let me turn to you and ask if there is some adrenaline that stops flowing a little bit after that long three-minute break.
I don't think so. In fact, in hot weather like this, it could be a break for them to come back. It's just a little something to get you refreshed. And you know, we've talked about the courage of Steve Young. Let's not forget Bobby Hebert, the Cajun Cannon. He's been playing with pain today, too. He's had a bad cartilage in the knee, which will probably require surgery once the season is completed for Michigan.
Hebert now 10 of 20, 135 yards, two touchdowns. This is Terry Miller, who goes around the right side, picks up three. It'll be second and seven.
Stats on regulation play now, Tim. Let's take a look. And you see one of the interesting things. Michigan, normally a time of possession team, has been dominated by Los Angeles 35-31 to 24-29. L.A. might have won the game in regulation time had it not been for three turnovers. Total yards very close, 347 to 314. This game, as I've said, Tim, has been one of the best that we have covered this year, if not the best.
Bobby Hebert had just three pass interceptions in the first 6 weeks of this season. His team was 6-0, but then he had 19 interceptions in the next eight games, and they struggled. This, a little screen pass. It goes back to his tight end, Mike Cobb, and Cobb has a lot of running room into the Los Angeles territory. I also should make mention that Bobby Hebert has not thrown an interception in the last four ball games.
Play that we saw Cobb work earlier, or rather Hebert work earlier, rollout screen where he throws back to the tight end. Set up well there. Good blocking for Mike Cobb. Creates an open field situation. Loses one tackler. And now it's going to set it up for Novo Bjovic, if necessary.
Novo's longest field goal this year is 56 yards. 28 remaining in the overtime period. Sudden death, first to score wins. This is Miller, who bulls his way down and drops the football, but the whistle is blown.
Remember what we said at the top of the show. This is a team that has playoff experience. They've been there. The Panthers were here last year. They are the defending champions, and they have veterans with playoff experience. Bobby Hebert now 11 of 21 in the passing department for 165 yards. He picked up 16 yards on that last completion to Mike Cobb. Terry Miller with 10 yards on that last carry now has 49 yards on the day with eight carries. Comparative stats there of the two quarterbacks.
First down, Michigan. Inside is Williams. Dwight Drain comes up and makes the tackle, and I doubt very seriously if we'll see Michigan go back to the air. Now it's all positioning, ground control. Set it up for Novo Bjovic.
We said of Novo when we spotlighted him at the top of the show, because he's the most flamboyant kicker we have ever seen, the most demonstrative, we forget how fundamentally sound he really is. Short range, medium range, and long range.
John Williams now has 96 yards and 17 carries, coming off his best game. He had 161 last week, in the season finale. This is Williams again.
John Williams trying to run the long trap play off the left side, a play that's been effective for him throughout most of the season.
John Williams to the 19-yard line. Novobjovic now inside the 30 this year is 9 of 11. Michigan has two timeouts remaining, and Jim Stanley wants a timeout now. Both teams have been given two timeouts for this overtime period. Michigan uses its first.
OT is exciting.
It is, but you have to wonder now, the young team that is out there for the LA Express has to have its head on a swivel, has to be searching a little bit. With his confidence shaken against the wall here, a field goal can win it. They know that, and they know they're going against one of the game's best in Novobjovic.
So it's going to take a sensational defensive effort now by the Express.
You have to wonder, too, if the defense might just gamble it a little bit, show a lot of man defense, try to play some games up front, get the linebackers to fill quickly and jar the ball loose.
They can afford to do that because they can pretty much assume that Michigan is not going to pass.
Let's take you back and show you how we got into overtime. Los Angeles had its back against the wall. Turnovers had hurt the Express badly.
The touchdown was by Kevin Nelson, number three, who went off the right side behind his blockers. He snuck underneath the coverage there, kind of squirmed into the end zone. That set up the two-point play by Steve Young. Play action to his right. Now he's going to come back to his left and watch the block by number 86, Mike Sherrod, on number 52, Kyle Borland at the corner that springs Steve Young into the end zone. Actually, it was Mike Edwards, number 53, that took the block from Mike Sherrod.
Third down, call it five. Big play for Michigan. Play action. Hebert under trouble. And under that pressure, he bounces the ball out of bounds. The crowd wanted intentional grounding. There is no call. But it'll bring on Novobjovic on fourth down to try to win it.
The crowd may have a point. I didn't see any eligible receivers in the area.
Novo kicked a 29-yarder to beat Houston with 36 seconds left in overtime earlier this year. He's won three games this year with field goals. He sets this ball and tees it up at the 27-yard line. That'll make it a 37-yard attempt. Between the 30 and 39, he's 5 of 8 this year. He missed a 46-yarder in the second quarter. And Los Angeles will try to ice him a little bit. Was it L.A. Cupper that called this timeout? Here's a look at John Hadle.
Apparently it was.
Jim Stanley, the head coach, in his second year with the Michigan Panthers, turned things around last year after winning just one game in the first 7 weeks. Had his team come back and win 12 of the next 14 to take the first ever USFL title. All the pressure is on that man, Novobjovic.
Both coaches essentially are fundamentalists, Tim, but both of them will take chances. They will gamble on fourth down, for example, occasionally show you gadget plays.
All the pressure is not on Novo. The snapper is David Tipton. He had a high snap that caused Novo to miss a field goal earlier from 46 yards. The holder is Whit Taylor.
It's one of those consummate teamwork plays in football. The center, the holder, the kicker.
The winner advances to the Western Conference Championship. The game is on the line. It's on the shoulders of Novobjovic, the kicker. High snap. It gets down in time. The kick is long enough. It's no good. Novobjovic has missed it. There's new life for Los Angeles. And there's new life for John Hadle. And again, David Tipton's snap looked a little bit high.
A look from the end zone, and let's see if the snap is high as Whit Taylor. Let's watch the hands of Whit Taylor. No, it appeared to be a good snap. The ball is put down well. Novo simply hooked this one, it appeared to me, Tim. Let's watch Novo's reaction. Ball is put down well. Novo thinks he has it initially, then knows he doesn't, and he's very disappointed with himself. That's twice today he's hooked it.
From Titograd, Yugoslavia, Novo Bojovic. So Michigan has had its shot. Now it's time for Los Angeles. Mel Gray, right side, picks up seven. It'll be second and three. Vito McKeever came up to make the tackle.
So everything we said in this division playoff at the top of the show has come true, Tim. All of the individual and collective matchups that we spotlighted have been in evidence today. We've had everything we ever wanted in this ball game, and maybe a little bit more.
Malcolm Moore comes to the bottom of the screen. JoJo Townsell to the top. Tony Bodie. And this man are your eye back, Mel Gray. Mel Gray has the first down for Los Angeles.
Kevin Nelson and Mel Gray have taken turns running from the fullback or ace back position today and have been particularly effective on that play, the power pitch, and also on the blast play. We have not seen Kevin Mack. We talked about the trio of runners at the very top of the show. Kevin Mack has not been in evidence today, but Mel Gray certainly has. 23 carries now for 84 yards.
You saw John Hadle give the play to David Hersey. This is Mel Gray, who jitterbugs and sidesteps his way to the 42-yard line. John Hadle knows about the pressure of playoff games. As a quarterback of the Chargers, Hadle led San Diego to the Western Division title in 1963, 64, 65. He won the AFL title in 1963.
He had a couple fair runners that year, though, in Lincoln and Lowe.
A very dejected Novo Bojovic. Second down, call it six. Play action, Young, backside pressure, throws anyway, has Townsell, first down express.
Safety blitz was on by Tom Moriarty. Play action pass by Steve Young, looks first to his right and then comes back to his left to number 26, JoJo Townsell, who's covered there by cornerback Oliver Davis, number 21. Good call and good execution by Steve Young.
Sid Gilman, the father of the modern passing game, who was an offensive consultant here in Los Angeles, called Steve Young one of the greatest he has ever seen. Here comes the blitz by the Panthers. The give is to Mel Gray, and he picks up one, maybe two. But Mike Edwards, the linebacker, was coming.
You mentioned Sid Gilman, you mentioned John Hadle. Maybe we should also mention Don Klosterman, the general manager. It's a reunion for them. All of them were together back in the early 60s with first the Los Angeles Chargers, then the San Diego Chargers.
Steve Young guided Brigham Young to an 11-1 record last year, number 7 national ranking. He caught the winning touchdown against Missouri in the Holiday Bowl. 14-yard trick pass. First ever reception for Steve Young. This is Tony Bodie in motion. Again, there's pressure. This time he drops it off to Kevin Nelson, and Nelson gets back to the line of scrimmage. Ray Bentley was the linebacker who read the play, kept his leverage, used the sidelines, played it inside out, and made the tackle.
Ray Bentley, who has 93 solo tackles on the year with 43 assists, breaks through the wall right here and makes the tackle on number 3, Kevin Nelson, who was trying to take that little slip screen and get into an open field situation.
It brings up third and long. The Express are 3 of 9 today on third down conversions. Freddie Scott and Malcolm Moore, twin receivers, top of the screen. On third down conversion, they hit 40% of them. This one is no good. It was intended for Malcolm Moore. The fans wanted pass interference on Bob Futrell, and so did Moore. Well, we've seen Los Angeles go for the fourth down conversion 3 times today offensively, but this time Partridge is on and he'll punt it.
Steve Young has been effective today with middle routes, particularly the crisscrosses. This time he's trying to go to number 84, Malcolm Moore. Bobby Futrell is not cited for interference there, Tim, but it's an awfully questionable call.
Partridge threw a completed pass on a fake punt in the third quarter. He was called back because of a penalty. This time he punts it away. It's the sideline Kaufman corner that'll go out of bounds on the 14-yard line. Well, now they mark it on the 12-yard line. Nonetheless, Michigan is backed against the wall. We are in overtime, and we've got 5 minutes and 35 seconds remaining in the L.A. Coliseum. We want to welcome those of you who have been watching the New Jersey-Philadelphia game. Philadelphia advances to the Eastern Conference Championship game, and will play the winner of the Tampa Bay-Birmingham game, which will be played tomorrow at Legion Field. Here at the Los Angeles Coliseum, we have 5 minutes, 35 seconds remaining in the overtime period. Novo Bjovic just missed the field goal. L.A. came back with a pretty good drive, but had to punt it away. Coffin corner kick. Left the ball on the 12-yard line, and that's where the Panthers have it. First down. Bobby Hebert, play action, throws across the middle, almost intercepted. It was intended for Derek Holloway.
Wyman Henderson nearly picked the ball off. Number 22 at his cornerback position as he stepped in front of the Holloway.
Philadelphia has advanced with a 28-7 win over New Jersey. That eliminates the Generals for the year. And Philadelphia, last year's runner-up, the team which lost to the Michigan Panthers in Denver, advances to the Eastern Conference Championship. Second down and 10 for Bobby Hebert. Had plenty of time. And a receiver across the middle. It's complete to Ken O'Neill, who takes it up to the 45-yard line. Big play for the Panthers. Dwight Crane, the defender, had to take him down from behind. Ken O'Neill out of Idaho State.
Ken O'Neill is wide open here as he sneaks up the middle. He goes across and then up, and he gets into the seam of the zone coverage there. Dwight Drain is the only man who can bring him down, and he runs him down from behind. That's what's sometimes known as a sneak pattern.
Los Angeles had gone to a pass defense. They had loosened up. They had put in an extra defensive back, and the middle was open for the tight end O'Neill. Hebert now 12 of 23, 198 yards. Flags fly this time. It looks as if Georgia Chica may have jumped too early.
False start on the quarterback.
Oh, my. They mark it against Bobby Hebert.
It's an interesting call. False start on the quarterback, Bobby Hebert.
I didn't see it. Unless he drew him off with an uneven cadence. But that's legal. Let's go back a play. Ken O'Neill, who made the big catch, did not play in the first 16 games this year. Only one catch in the regular season. It is first and 15 for the Panthers. Anthony Allen in motion. Hebert with time drops it off across the middle. And Derek Holloway has not much time. Let's go downstairs now. Here's Ted Dawson.
Thank you, Tim. Steve Young, what's it like sitting here on the sidelines knowing it could end at any second?
Well, we got our chance and we didn't get to take advantage of it. We're not going to get many chances in overtime. If we get another one, we've got to do it right now.
You tried running a lot the last time. Will you pass more to get back out there?
I hope so.
Okay, Steve Young. Tim, you heard it.
All right, Ted, you see the numbers on Steve Young. Gutsy performance by him. The final drive inside a minute in regulation. He was hurt twice but stayed in the ballgame. When John Hadle sent Frank Sire into the ballgame to replace him, Steve Young said no way, sent Sire back out, and ended up scoring the two-point conversion. Nickel defense now for L.A. They're in man coverage. Now dropped back into his zone. It's almost intercepted.
It is.
Dwight Drain. Dwight Drain at the 40. Now backpedals, loses ground, but nonetheless, a big turnover, and Los Angeles gets the football back. So L.A. went to a nickel defense, showed man, dropped off into his zone, and confused Hebert a little bit and made the interception.
It's a good point. Hebert did appear confused, and he's tentative. Watch as he throws here. He appears very tentative. Straight drop back, good protection. He's aiming for Derek Holloway. See that? He doesn't finish. He doesn't finish with his delivery. And as a result, the ball is thrown softly toward Ken O'Neill, and Holloway is intercepted by Dwight Drain. Drain makes a mistake here, though, in backpedaling.
Hebert forced it into coverage. There were four white jerseys Steve Young said, if we get another second chance, we've got to push it in. 3 minutes, 32 seconds, drained down.
Looks like a muscle cramp.
It's a warm day in Los Angeles. Temperature in the upper 80s. Little swing pass overthrown. Looked like Kevin Nelson. Didn't know whether to go for it or not. Dwight Crane's in pain.
As I said, usually you feel it's some type of a muscle cramp, which can be very, very painful.
Let's see if we can get an update on that. That's right. Let's go down to Ted Dawson. Ted?
Thank you very much. I'm standing right next to Dwight Drain, who just made that interception. He's got a very bad cramp in his left leg. The trainers are working on him right now. It's not serious. It is just a cramp. But he is very, very overheated, and that's what they're worried about right now.
Second and 10 for the offense. Malcolm Moore to the bottom of the screen. JoJo Townsend to the top. This is Tony Bodie in motion. Nelson is the lone setback. Young to throw, has time, and has a completion. Malcolm Moore, close to a first down, depends where they mark it.
Mike Edwards, marking it, it will be a first down the way they're marking it, Tim.
Mike Edwards, the linebacker, and Oliver Davis, the cornerback, came up to make the tackle.
Malcolm Moore, who is 6 feet five and out of USC, is coming in from his wide receiver position from the outside in. He's covered by Oliver Davis, but his curl-in route is successful, and Young is right on the numbers there as he gets the first down yardage.
This is Nelson right side. Good play by the linebackers on that side. Robert Pennywill, Kyle Borland maintained containment, kept everything inside, strung the play out, and made the play. We are in overtime at the L.A. Coliseum. We've got 2 minutes, 23 seconds remaining. Michigan 21, Los Angeles 21. The winner of this game advances to the Western Conference Championship to play the winner of tomorrow's game, Arizona and Houston. Los Angeles with a dramatic comeback in regulation. The hero was Steve Young, who ran it in on a scramble for the two-point conversion to tie it. This is Young on second and long. Has the completion. There's not much yardage there. Tony Bodie may have picked up four.
Tony Bodie, the H-back, who has also played running back, starts to his right, motion back to his left. Now he's going to come on a slide-out pattern. Steve Young sprints to his left and then throws to Bodie before he's brought down along the sidelines. Bodie, of course, was the hero opening day last year when he got 77 yards to upstage Herschel Walker.
It is third down and eight. Los Angeles converts on third down 40% of the time. They have not been sharp here today on third downs. Young from the shotgun drills it across the middle, and it's incomplete, intended for Malcolm Moore. Looked like Moore stumbled just before the ball got there.
And not a well-thrown ball by Steve Young, but he was under a lot of pressure. Let's watch the pressure on Steve Young. Shotgun, straight drop back. Number 79, Larry Bethea, is coming around along with John Corker, number 57. Makes Young throw in a hurry.
So Partridge comes on to punt. Los Angeles now 3 of 11 on third down conversions. The two deep men, Walter Broughton and Anthony Allen. We've got 1 minute, 10 seconds remaining in the first overtime period. Partridge going for the corner. High spiraling punt. Will he get it? No, it goes into the end zone. They'll rule it a touchback. So they bring it out to the 20-yard line. It was a 49-yard punt. It missed by inches, and Michigan will have the ball when we come back. In a back alley brawl, that time remaining, 1:02, is in the overtime period. 21 for Michigan, 21 for Los Angeles. The first playoff game ever for L.A. For Michigan, well, the Panthers are the defending USFL champion. Bobby Hebert, 13 of 27 for 201 yards. Did have a pass interception his last time out. This is John Williams. Breaks a tackle, but Howard Carson comes over, strings it out, and runs him out of bounds. John Williams has been the workhorse.
Well, he had 161 yards last week, as we look at John Hadle talking to Steve Young along the sidelines. That was his second best effort ever. He had 165-yard effort. Turnovers three apiece today, Tim, but the difference is that Michigan has converted twice, turned those turnovers into touchdowns. Los Angeles has yet to do that.
I like that Hadle Young picture. The old and the young. John Hadle, 44 years old.
Pun intended.
Probably feels older than that today, doesn't he? Trying to advance for the first time ever into the championship game. This is Terry Miller. Terry Miller picks up a couple of more. Up to the 25-yard line. That'll bring up third down. And about four and a half.
Third and a crucial 5 yards now for quarterback Bobby Hebert as he looks to the sidelines, then looks at his wrist. And now he's going to make a decision.
I wouldn't be a bit surprised to see him play it fairly close to the vest here with 25 seconds left. They seem intent to let the clock roll and get into another overtime period. There's your time at the bottom right hand of the screen. They mark it at third and five. Hebert to pass. With backside pressure. He doesn't see it coming, and he's going to be sacked. Eddie Meek Cleaver, Weaver out of Georgia. Third sack of the day for Eddie Weaver.
Eddie Meek Cleaver Weaver, who has been effective all afternoon and throughout the season as a sack man and a harasser of quarterbacks, comes up on the blind side there of Bobby Hebert and really crunches him to the ground.
Hebert hurt. He's been nagged by a knee injury. They say he may need knee surgery when the season is concluded. He's obviously in pain here. He told Ted Dawson earlier in this ball game that his knee was locking up on him, and it kept getting worse. You know, when you look at that replay, he was awfully lucky to hold on to the football. He had it away from his body.
When the knee locks, that means cartilage.
Weaver could have stripped him. Hebert leaves the game, 13 of 27, 201 yards. And that'll be it for the overtime. This is now the longest game in USFL history. Michigan was involved in the other. It took 14 minutes and 1 second to decide a winner against Houston this year. We're tied 21-21. We'll be back with more sudden death action after a word from our local station. Stay with us. We are back at the L.A. Coliseum. Our score, 21-21. Overtime period. The second overtime now. They don't have a flip of the coin. They just pick up where they left off at the end of the first OT. It is the longest game in USFL history right now. Skip Johnson gets off of Boomer. It's taken by Dwight Gunn, or Dwayne Gunn, rather. And Dwayne returns it to the 45-yard line. This game could have been over long ago had Novo converted.
Tim, reflecting back to the first overtime period when Michigan got the ball and drove to the 27-yard line, this 37-yard attempt by Novo Bojovic is hooked to the left side here. It appears like it's going straight originally, then it begins to fade. He had hooked it, and we saw earlier his disappointment. That could have won the game for Michigan in the initial overtime period.
Malcolm Moore, JoJo Townsell are your wide receivers. Young scrambles, and he hits Malcolm Moore, who does a little pirouette and goes out of bounds close to a first down. Well, Steve Young's greatest asset has to be his escape dimension. He puts pressure on the corners, which takes the pressure off the wideouts.
We mentioned the reaction of Novo Bojovic when he missed the field goal. Whit Taylor gets the ball down successfully. Originally, it looks like he hits it well. Then he sees that he has hooked the ball, and you get that feeling of disappointment. Now he's very frustrated. We talked about how demonstrative and flamboyant he is.
Mel Gray, Tony Bodie, the I-backs. The give is to Gray. Picks up two. Mike Edwards, the linebacker, makes the tackle along with John Banasek. Ted Dawson downstairs now with Novo Bojovic.
Novo, we've just shown a couple of times of that hook you just missed, but you said to me that the wind in here played some funny tricks on you.
Exactly, Ted. You know, this one is very funny. Last time I had a hard time, the wind, I was judging the wind, and the wind opposite way by the goalpost where I'm kicking from. So really, it's tough, and next time I'm just going to have to go straight down the middle and whatever wind take it.
You want another chance. You're not worried about it then, huh?
Yeah, I hope I get another chance because it's going to be all over. I hope not get another chance.
Okay, Tim.
Third down, 3.5. Mel Gray punches his way up close to the 45. He'll be, maybe inches shy of the first down. It'll bring up fourth, I believe. Awfully, awfully close. We'll see where they mark it. Tony Zendejas is the field goal kicker for Los Angeles.
They're going to go for it.
Goal with 46 yards against Michigan.
They're going for it, Tim.
In college, he had a 56 and a 53-yarder in the first playoff round to beat Idaho State last fall. Michigan, fourth down, or Los Angeles, rather, fourth down and inches. Today, they're 4-for-4 on fourth down conversion. The give inside, first down, L.A. Again, they follow the blocking of Jeff Hart and Mike Durrett.
Highway 60. That's the route that Mel Gray, number 30, is taking as he follows number 60, Mike Durrett, his right guard, and number 72, Jeff Hart, his right tackle.
Had a long talk with Jeff Hart yesterday and the day before out at the L.A. Express training camp. 5 years with the Baltimore Colts as a starter. This is his first ever playoff game, though. He said, I just want him to follow me all day long. This is Young, pumps, reloads, throws to JoJo Townsell. Incomplete. Good no call on the interference by Vito McKeever. No flag, and it's a good no call. There shouldn't have been interference.
Isolation on JoJo Townsell. Little juke step to the inside, back to the outside on the fade or fly pattern. Vito McKeever step-for-step coverage. I agree with you, Tim. Good no call.
Although he's got to be careful with that right arm.
Is that really a word, no call? Or did we just make it up?
Just make it up as you go along. This is a long ball game. This is Mel Gray, right side to the 40-yard line. Los Angeles, 5-for-5 on fourth down conversions, including a touchdown to set up the two-point conversion by Steve Young to win it within a minute of regulation. Both quarterbacks have been dragged from the field and helped off this afternoon. Twice on the final drive of regulation, Steve Young went down. John Hadle sent in Frank Sire, the backup, and Young reached deep down inside. Intestinal fortitude sent Young back, or sent Sire back, rather. Stayed in the ball game and ended up the hero thus far. We understand that Bobby Hebert, who was helped off the field with a bad knee, will be back. This is Young on third and long. In trouble. Throws it in the direction of Malcolm Moore, incomplete. And Young is shaken up again.
Ground level look here at Steve Young. Well, we're not going to see it right now, but you can see that Steve Young has been shaken up again, as you said. We saw him hurt in the ball game against Oklahoma 3 weeks ago on a controversial late hit. That was by Clay Rule in that game.
This is Los Angeles, third punt in the overtime. Jeff Partridge is the punter. And if he gets it to the corner, it should back up Michigan. But he won't. It'll hit on the 20 and get a Michigan roll. They will not have that bad field position. Let's see how Steve Young got hurt.
Steve Young throwing on a third and obvious pass situation, takes a seven-step drop, tries to apply some of that escape dimension, and then he's hit by number 93 of the Michigan Panthers. That's Jay Hayes, the defensive end. It looks like he may have fallen on his wrist or his thumb.
Well, he's obviously hurt. He's obviously in pain. They are working on that right thumb. A 17-yard punt by Jeff Partridge. That's the second time we've seen him go for the coffin corner, shank it just a bit, and come up shy.
Reflecting on Steve Young's thumb, I was thinking about it, Tim. What it might affect the way he takes the snap from center. It's his right thumb, so it's not on his passing hand, but it could affect the center snap.
Whit Taylor. Back is Whit Taylor. We saw Bobby Hebert leave the ball game. His knee was injured. He ends up 13 of 27 for 201 yards. Whit Taylor gives it John Williams, and Williams has a hole. Breaks two tackles, gets to the outside. Close to a first down for Michigan. Well, let's try to get an update on Steve Young now. Here's Ted Dawson. Ted?
Thank you, Tim. I think you can see they're putting ice on his right hand. As you mentioned before, Steve is left-handed, of course. It is not the thumb. It's the meaty part of the hand. However, Steve says he will be able to play if the Express gets the ball back.
Gutsy performance by Steve Young today. Bobby Hebert has paid his dues, put in a very, very tough afternoon. He's had cartilage problem, will need knee surgery at the end of this year. Whit Taylor, very confident, came in and replaced Bobby Hebert against San Antonio and pulled that game out of the fire for Michigan. Then started against Oakland. They lost that one. He was removed as the starter. Bobby Hebert came back. The give that time was to Cleo Miller. Cleo Miller, 9 years in the NFL for the Browns and the Chiefs. Has only two touchdowns, Cupper, in this league, both of them in playoff games.
However, we've seen him at times be effective as a lead blocker, as well as a tough short yardage runner.
Russ Jensen is warming up. I'd like to know who he's warming up with, because I bet on the other side of those passes is Frank Sire, who would be the replacement if Young can't come back. John Williams.
John Williams
on third and inches, and he has the first.
There's Frank Sire. Most prolific passer in Big 8 history during his time at Kansas. Grew up here in Southern California.
Frank Sire, 2-2 as a starter. Beat Oakland and San Antonio. Lost to Jacksonville and Arizona. 10 minutes, 2 seconds remaining in the second overtime period. Ed Carey puts Williams at 111 yards for the afternoon and 21 carries. He had 161 yards and 15 carries last week. USFL Player of the Week. First down, Whit Taylor with time. Throws across the middle. Intended for Miller. It's intercepted by Aaron Mitchell. Mitchell brings it back to the 40, to the 38-yard line. Aaron Mitchell. Listen to the crowd. Aaron Mitchell had two interceptions in the playoffs in 1980 for the Dallas Cowboys.
Whit Taylor, who has replaced Bobby Hebert in the game after play action fake, looks left, looks right, now looks down the middle, and he's throwing for Terry Miller, number 43. The ball is tipped by number 54, Howard Carson, then intercepted by Aaron Mitchell, number 34, who runs the ball back into opportune field position for Los Angeles.
Two National Football League veterans, Howard Carson, Aaron Mitchell, the tip and the interception. We've got 9 minutes, 12 seconds in overtime, the second overtime. This is Kevin Nelson, who spins, turns, and drives his way back up to the line of scrimmage. Great pursuit by the defense.
Frank Sire was warming up, but Steve Young has returned to the football game once again, Tim. We are already in the longest game in USFL history. This makes me think back to 1962 when Houston played Kansas City.
Malcolm Moore comes to the bottom of the screen. JoJo Townsell to the top. The motion man is Tony Bodie. Young on second and long across the middle, incomplete. It was intended to the tight end, Mike Sherrod. But now, all of a sudden, Los Angeles is close to the range of Tony Zendejas, the field goal kicker. It'll bring up a third down and 10. And Los Angeles today, a woeful 3 for 13 on third down conversions. Shotgun formation. Third and long, flags fly. Here's your call.
False start on the right guard. Third down.
Critical mistake. A mental error by the LA Express moves them back. And every yard now is critical. It's paramount that they gain yardage, not lose it.
False start on the right side means number 60, Mike Durrett. See that right there? He cheated with his left foot. He tried to get back. He's called for the infraction.
That could prove catastrophic. Freddie Scott, Malcolm Moore come to the bottom of the screen. Twin receivers, shotgun formation. Hersey and Townsell, the top of the screen. Pressure on Young. Throws complete to Freddie Scott, the longtime veteran of the National Football League. And another controversial call. They rule it incomplete.
Los Angeles, again, on the wrong end of a controversial call. Pass thrown by Young over the middle, intended for Fred Scott.
That's a completion.
It appears to be a completion. It appeared that he scooped the ball and then rolled with it.
Well, well, Jeff Partridge now. Fourth punt in overtime. Again, he goes for the corner. This time he drives it toward that corner, but it will go into the end zone for a touchback. A controversial call. Freddie Scott appeared to make the catch. Right now he's with Ted Dawson. Teddy?
Thank you, Tim. Fred, we showed the replay. It looked like you made the catch. What did you think?
Well, I thought I got up under the ball. You know, if there was any question in anyone's mind, it was only on one of the referees. So it's done. Now the only thing we can do is get back into it, take advantage of whatever opportunity confronts us later.
What did the official tell you?
You want to say that there's just one guy. In fact, two of the guys were marking it good, and the other guy was just came in from the another angle and said it was no good.
That's the story, Tim.
And appeared to make that catch, ruled incomplete. 7 minutes, 50 seconds remaining in the second overtime. With Taylor, still the quarterback, Terry Miller, the ball carrier. Hard hitting. For the most part, well-educated and well-executed. Good play by Georgia Chica, who came through cleanly and made the tackle on Terry Miller. 6 minutes, 35 seconds remaining now in the overtime period, the second overtime period in Los Angeles. With Taylor on third and seven, throws. It's complete to his tight end, Mike Cobb. The 34-yard line. Michigan has first down. This is Miller. And Miller fights his way, but Eddie Weaver outmuscles him. In the secondary. Actually, it's more like a dime look now with six defensive backs. With Taylor, under pressure, throws across the middle. There is a flag. Troy West made the tackle on Anthony Allen.
Okay, Tim, that's Jeff Hart.
With Taylor. On second and 22, throws long to Holloway, and it's intercepted and dropped. Holloway wants pass interference. Lee Williams comes in. Dime defensive back. Six of them. Dime defense. The pass across the middle is caught. Tremendous catch by Anthony Allen. Anthony Allen to the bottom of the screen. The top is Derek Holloway. Whit Taylor is now the quarterback. He's replaced Bobby Hebert. Halfback option pass. Ken Lacy throws it up, and it is caught by Derek Holloway. Or is that Derek Holloway? Yes, it is. This is third down and eight. Miller, right side. Picks up three, maybe four. 39 seconds remaining in the second overtime period. It's long enough.
Forever.
Oh, but it's fun.
I'm having a a good time. How about you, buddy?
I love it. And that'll be it. So, Steve Young, number 8. The great, great, great grandson of Brigham Young comes off the field. We are now told this is the longest game in pro football history. The score, the defending USFL champion Michigan Panthers 21, the Los Angeles Express 21. We'll be back. Now that it is the longest game in pro football history, the defending champion Michigan Panthers against the Los Angeles Express. We are deadlocked at 21. There is exhaustion on both sides of the field. They had difficulty making it off the field after Novo Bjovic missed his third field goal of the day. We have a 3-minute intermission, and we'll pick up right where we left off at the end of the second overtime. Right now, Ted Dawson is with JoJo Townsell.
Thank you very much, Tim. JoJo Townsell, how long can you keep going? What's it like?
Everybody's kind of tired, but we're happy to be here. And
is it tougher on the defense right now?
I don't think so. It's tough for both respective teams, offensive and defensive. There's just so much intensity out there, and everybody's legs is dying out that the play isn't maybe as good as it was earlier. But everybody's still out there trying their best, but it's hard to, you know, keep going.
Will the Express on this drive come out and throw the ball?
Well, we've been trying. We haven't been that successful in the overtime period, but we're still trying to do whatever we can to win this game.
Okay, JoJo. Tim?
It was Michigan that won the toss for the first overtime period, and they elected to receive. They continued play at the end of the second overtime period. Now, Michigan kicks off to Los Angeles to start the third overtime period. It's Tony Bodie to the 20, to the 25-yard line. And there's good coverage by the Michigan special teams. Time elapsed 4 hours, the longest game in pro football history. Tim Brandon, Lee Grosskopf from the L.A. Coliseum. Rule in this league, a dress code, where your socks have to be pulled high. And it looks from here, and we are way up, that Steve Young is taking his blue socks off. This is Steve Young, drops, throws, has a man. It's JoJo Townsell to the 43-yard line. First down, Los Angeles. Vito McKeever, the defensive back.
That's a big play for the Express. They now have good field position, Tim.
First down from the 44. Young with time, backside pressure now. Gets out of it, throws. It's complete. This is Mel Gray. Mel Gray to the 46-yard line. Oh, what a game Steve Young's playing. The 1983 Heisman Trophy runner-up to Mike Rozier.
And the most accurate passer in NCAA history. Zimmerman cramping along the sidelines now.
You talk about Young's accuracy. He completed 14 of 16 passes for 87% against Oakland earlier this year. Young throws. JoJo Townsell is open to the 30. Almost breaks away to the 23-yard line before Oliver Davis can take him down from behind.
After a short post pattern, he comes with a deep post pattern. JoJo Townsell there is in front of Oliver Davis, number 21, shakes the tackle, moves upfield for 5 additional yards before he's brought down by number 45, Tom Moriarty. Here it is, deeper post, goes to 15, makes his cut, beats Oliver Davis, and is brought down by Moriarty.
The ebb and flow of emotions. Michigan now feeling the pressure and fatigue. The adrenaline flowing in Los Angeles. The players now seem more pumped up. They've got a bounce in their step. This is first down. The give inside goes Mel Gray to the 24-yard line. Mel Gray, a 4-4 sprinter out of Purdue.
And now we have to talk about Tony Zendejas. We are within his range now, Tim.
Well within his range. His longest field goal, a 46-yarder against Michigan, May 20th. In college, he had a 56-yarder, a 53-yarder.
Earlier today, he made a 32-yarder. That was in the second quarter. Then he made a 34-yarder. That was in the third quarter.
Zendejas has 10 straight field goals. He attempted a 50-yarder and a 60-yarder earlier this year against Houston. 11 straight. This is the give inside again to Gray. Gray, side.
He could go
outside. 5 to the 3. Touchdown, Los Angeles. It's over. Crowd. still down, totally exhausted. A fitting finale to the most incredible game in USFL history. Mel Gray starts left, back to the right, traverses the field, makes a cut to the outside. Now it's a foot race. He beats number 36, Beto McKeever, on a 24-yard run. 4 hours and 3 minutes. This game is history. The Los Angeles Express, in their first playoff game ever, have not only made history, they have advanced to the Western Conference Championship, where they will play the winner of tomorrow's Arizona-Houston game. Let's go down quickly now to Ted Dawson.
Thank you very much, Tim. This is Ted Dawson. This is Mel Gray right here on the sideline. As you can see, the trainers are working over him. He just scored the winning touchdown in the ball game, but he is almost unconscious. He is still conscious, but he is laying here. He says he's got a very bad pain in his left shoulder. So the trainers are working over him right now. I think you can see this camera shot here of all three trainers working on him right now. But Mel Gray scored the winning touchdown in this game. He is conscious, but it's still a little too early to tell just how badly he's hurt.
Once again, the final score, Los Angeles 27, Michigan eliminated from the playoffs 21. The game lasted 4 hours and 3 seconds. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies to Hong Kong from more top business centers with three-class Royal Pacific service. This has been an ABC Sports presentation, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television. This year, the Olympic tradition continues.